Okay, we'll call this meeting to order. This is the March 2nd Yellow Springs Village Council meeting. Welcome to the inaugural meeting of our new dais and new council chambers arrangement. Just to remind you, the biggest reason for doing it had to do with audio and sound and filming, and also the fact that we had to make, we wanted to make this a joint unit between Mayor's Court and us, so that staff didn't have to bring in the large oak piece every couple of weeks, and it was just, you know, an extra step for staff to have to do. So it was a way to combine everything into a unit that seemed to, and into a layout that seemed to be a little bit more accessible. I mean, right now, I'm feeling like the communication between council and the community is actually a little bit closer, even though we're sitting a little higher, it feels like we're closer. So hopefully, I think, hopefully it's going to work out. Unfortunately, we don't have all of the audio, we don't have some of the AV upgrades that we were hoping for, that's going to come in the next, probably in another couple of months, we'll get everything finished. So, thanks, I guess I should have asked Judy to call the roll first.
I'll do that.
Okay.
Metro.
Here.
Asklin.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
Howe.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Also present is Village Manager Patty Bates, Assistant Village Manager John Young, Chief of Police Dave Hale, Jason Hamby, Streets and Parks Supervisor Johnny Burns, Electric Supervisor, and Village Solicitor Chris Connor.
Okay, so we have some announcements. On March 18th from 7 to 9 p.m., we have a public forum with HNTV, their consultant, our design build consultant for the water plant. And we will, they will be doing a summary of what's happened so far, but the primary purpose of that meeting is to discuss softening options with the public. So I know that that's been a hotly debated topic on the topic of the water plant, so we invite everybody to be there. I think, is it going to be an A and B, or it will be in rooms A and B?
Yeah, I think it's probably going to be.
And the joint meeting of Miami Township Trustees and Council, March 30th at 7, I think we should probably schedule that for A and B also. And then we also have a council retreat. We'll talk about that a little bit later, but as it turns out, Judy was able to figure out that March 31st is the only date available that all of council could meet. And Brian, you do have a HRC?
Yeah, again, on March 19th, we have the community conversation with Chief Hale, and that's going to be in the Bryan Center Gym from 7 to 9 p.m. Yeah, maybe just to highlight a few key topics, we're going to be talking about police department policy plans and also the ACE task force.
Okay, any other announcements? Next, we have the review of the minutes of the February 17th meeting, page one, page two, page three, page four, page five, six, seven, eight, and nine.
Yes, a change on nine. With the paragraph about halfway down where it says the environmental commission, the meeting was with Patty Bates, myself, and Nadia Malarkey, not Melissa.
Oh, okay. Okay, can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Next, review of the agenda. Anything that we want to change or add to the agenda?
We have a nomination for an HRC alternate.
Okay. Add that into new business. Lori, do you, want to review the petitions?
Well, we have the marriage matters resolutions included in petitions. That will be on our agenda next month.
Is it March 7th?
I'm sorry, this month. Our next meeting. Dylan Borcher sent a thank you note for Rickard Eckler. Yolanda Simpson sent a note thanking a police officer. She didn't get the name or number, but he offered assistance, and she was grateful and wanted to just offer thanks.
Dave, do we know who that is?
No.
Okay.
There will be a forum called Fiber Forum, and it's about fiber optic and community broadband options. It's April 25th, 9 to 1, at Nebecca, at 330 East Dena, not South Bend High School. It's speakers and a lunch workshop, but I think you do have to RSVP if you want to go. And there was a letter from the Community Access panel about programming and needing more volunteers. They've included a list of the current programming. A reminder that the Antioch College Village Charrette is happening this week, so if you weren't able to go on Monday, there's still opportunities to participate. The schedule is linked in our packet and available in places. And then Rachel McKinley included the treasurer's report. I'm not sure if we would make that an item of discussion. The treasurer's report really just focuses on our bank accounts and the fees that we pay to banks and any interest that we earn. A very limited ability to invest that money wisely. You don't want to buy, you know, stamps or something with it. We don't tend to get a lot of money back on our carried over balances on our bank accounts, but a few years ago we were getting some high fees, and those have, I would say, stayed fairly in the reasonable range.
We did get $3,200. We earned $3,200 on our investments in 2014.
Mm-hmm. Is that after fees?
Mm-hmm. That's just on the investments, but.
I think that's it.
Yeah.
Okay. And
Next we have a ordinance 2015-03, vacating an alley at the eastern edge of Marshall at Livermore.
Okay, whereas pursuant to Ohio Revised Code Section 723.05, the Village Council has determined that there is good cause for vacating an alley located east of Livermore Street between East and South College Street and Marshall Street as depicted on Attachment A, alley, and that such vacation will not be detrimental to the general interest. And whereas pursuant to Yellow Springs Ordinance 12.4.02, the Yellow Springs Planning Commission gave notice of a public hearing regarding vacation of this alley 10 days in advance in the local newspaper. All abutting property owners to the right-of-way in question were notified of the public hearing by mail. And whereas at the public hearing on this matter, no abutting property owners appeared to oppose the vacation, and the Yellow Springs Planning Commission has recommended vacation of this alley to the Council of the Village of Yellow Springs. Now, therefore, Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, Green County, hereby ordains that Section 1, Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, hereby accepts the recommendation of Planning Commission and finds there is good cause for vacation of the alley, and said vacation is not detrimental to the general interest of the public. Section 2, Council hereby orders the alley be vacated. Section 3, this ordinance should go into effect at the earliest period allowed by law.
Thank you. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Okay, John, we have a nice staff report from you.
Yeah, thanks for that.
Thank you. So we would appreciate you explaining this.
All right. This was a request to vacate the alley that's located. The picture is in your packet. It's located between Marshall and East South College Street along Livermore. In 2013, council approved vacation of an alley the same alley across the, on the other side of Livermore Street. This would be the alley that would be extending into Antioch College. It is where the South Gym is located. So there's actually a building sitting on top of this alley right away. My pad just flipped around. This came before the Planning Commission in December 8th of last year. And since the minutes have been approved, we've been able to move this forward to Village Council. The requirements for an alley vacation are outlined in Chapter 122402 of Village ordinances. They say that the Planning Commission should render a decision based on the following. The vacation is consistent with the Yellow Springs Conference plan, that staff recommendation concerning such things as needed present land use, adjacent property access, utility easement, transportation needs, the validity of the applicant's reason for requesting the vacation, the general citizen reaction to the proposed vacation, and the abutting property owners' support or lack thereof for proposed vacation, and that this recommendation be forwarded to Village Council. At the hearing in December, nobody spoke in opposition to the vacation. The Planning Commission made the findings pursuant to Chapter 122402 and recommending the approval of the vacation to Village Council. Do you guys have any questions regarding the report?
Any questions or comments? There will be two readings. This is the first reading. There will be another reading and a public hearing, but we will take comments. Any comments or questions from citizens? Okay. Bringing it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yeah.
Winthrop?
Yes. Next we have first reading of ordinance 2015-04, approving a water rate increase.
It's an ordinance amending section 1046.02 service charges of chapter 1046 water of part 10 streets, utilities, and public services code of the codified ordinances of the village of Yellow Springs, Ohio. Whereas the village water fund is least healthy of the various village funds, and whereas foreseeable capital improvement requirements will fully address the resources of the water fund, and whereas scheduled rate increases established in 2014 are proving insufficient to fund the needs of the water utility, now therefore Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio does hereby ordain that Section 1, the rate increase previously enacted on April 1, 2014 is hereby repealed. Section 2, in its place, a new rate to take effect on May 1, 2015 is hereby enacted as follows. Monthly readiness for service charge is $6.80. Consumption charge per 1,000 gallons is $5.77. Section 3, this ordinance should be in full force and effect 30 days following its adoption by council.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second. Okay. Patty, would you
The water fund is obviously not in really healthy shape right now, and we do have not only the water plant but also two water distribution projects, the completion and the bottleneck elimination. We will be hopefully awarding the contract on the loop completion tonight. So I talked to Melissa. She did a few calculations. To keep the water fund even and just make it break even at the end of the year requires a 6% increase. We are recommending a 10% increase on the consumption charge per 1,000 gallons, not on the monthly readiness for service charge. This will at least allow the fund to begin accumulating a little bit more revenue towards these projects. And when Karen from RCAP does our rate study, he will take into consideration that whatever we pass at the next council meeting.
Council questions? Patty? Citizens, again, this will have two readings. This is the first reading, and it will have a public hearing at the next meeting. Comments or questions from citizens? I'm bringing it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Asplund?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Winthrop?
Yes. Next is resolution 2015-8, awarding the loop completion project to GM Pipeline.
Okay, whereas the Village Council desires to improve the water distribution system of the Village of Yellow Springs, and whereas the Council has received quotes from seven contractors regarding this project,
And whereas GM Pipeline has provided the lowest and best quote, and whereas GM Pipeline has to date no unresolved findings for recovery on record, now therefore be it resolved by the Council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, that Section 1, the village manager is authorized to enter into a contract with GM Pipeline to install water lines as designated in the water loop completion project plans and documents. Section 2, said contract shall be for the amount of $764,053.39. Section 3, this resolution shall go into effect at the earliest period allowed by law.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty, would you explain a little bit more specifically the area of the project and also address the OPWC grant that we've received?
Right. The loop completion project includes the 100 block of Corey Street, part of the other stretch of Corey Street. Johnny, how far down?
It goes to Glen Street.
Okay, so down Corey from Xenia to Glen, and then there's a part that goes across to Livermore to the water towers, correct?
And also goes down line Livermore.
Right, Livermore down and across.
It actually goes from Glen Street to Northwest College or Northeast College.
And then down Livermore.
Correct.
And on out Herman to the water.
To the water tower.
And this project does have a $400,000 OPWC grant, so the cost to the village for this project will be the $364,053.39 that is left, and any change orders that may occur during the project.
Can you address schedule and the length of time it will take to complete the project and when it's expected to start?
I think Johnny could probably address that better than I can. Way more familiar.
As of right now, they're 120 days is what they're scheduling, and as soon as we get the contract signed, they're willing to start within like 30 days.
And they're going to start with
100 Dayton Street, or Corey Street will be the first one. They have to have that section complete by the first street fair. So they have to have a complete blacktop and move down that area.
And that is the most difficult section.
That is correct.
Because a lot of it is under the streets, and street will have to be dug up and then repaired.
And plus the traffic is a big one on that one too. We're trying to maintain traffic and the businesses at the same time.
Okay, and then everything after that, then everything will just, will it all be done at once, or will it kind of just continue?
Just probably continue straight down Corey.
Okay.
And
exactly.
Ending point would be the towers.
Okay. Any questions or comments from citizens? Council, are you ready to vote?
Maybe you could just say, what is the purpose of this? What's it?
It's to complete, there are some undersized and degraded lines throughout the system, and this completes the loop, the worst portions of the loop that makes the tower flow better to the north side of town. Then the bottleneck elimination will be along Xenia Avenue, to the south side of town to eliminate the smaller lines that go along Xenia Avenue there.
And this also does provide some benefit to Antioch College, because they had to put in fire flow devices, because their fire flow isn't adequate. So this will relieve them on some of their new construction. Okay, we're ready to vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
That was resolution. Right, so that's the only reading we'll have of that. Now is the time on the agenda for citizens' comments from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. 3 minutes, Judy will keep time, and we ask you to go to the non-working microphone, but to at least stand at the podium so people can see you and you can be heard better. Anything that's not on the agenda? Joan?
My concern has to do with a pothole that's a really bad pothole on Dayton Yellow Springs Road, just west of the light at East Enum. If you're coming toward the village, there's a huge pothole there that makes it very, that's a weird corner to try to turn anyhow. It's kind of a sharp angle. And it's almost impossible to miss that pothole. And if you're trying to not damage the right axle of your car and try to get around that and not run into somebody who's sitting on East Enum waiting to turn left, if somebody could please go out there and fill in that pothole. I mean, it's huge.
It's a huge pothole.
Just a side note on that, we will fix every pothole that's out there, the majority of the potholes, but we will not put stuff that's in there while we've got the plow, because it'll just kick back out. So we'll wait until everything gets settled down, where it's kind of mainly out of here, and then we'll start doing the potholes. Okay? And we will get to it.
I just want to reiterate what Lori already said about the fiber forum we're planning on April 25th at Rebecca. It's a free event, and there are brochures, I think, in the building are available outside. So hold the date open. We have some interesting speakers that we're planning to present. Most notably, a speaker from Dublin, Ohio, speaking about DoveNet. And we're going to have a remote speaker from Sandy, Oregon, both municipalities that have adopted networks of their own. I also want to mention that the Federal Communications Commission recently, on February 26, voted to enforce net neutrality rules that prevent internet providers from blocking or throttling traffic or giving priority to web services in exchange for payment. And this is a huge win for net neutrality. Most of you probably have heard about this. It reclassifies fixed and mobile broadband as a telecommunication service, which allows it to be regulated like common carriers under Title II of the Communications Act. So it effectively makes the internet a utility. In addition to that ruling, Yellow Springs, which is also a member of Next Century Cities, there was an additional ruling about Wilson, North Carolina, and Chattanooga. It's been 3 minutes?
No, she forgot how you said
it. I want to read a press release from Deb Socia, who is the executive director. And we supported this ruling in a letter that I believe Brian signed and sent to Next Century Cities. The FCC stood behind local leaders in Wilson, North Carolina, and Chattanooga, Tennessee, in their request for local choice. Decision was to support the petitions of these two Next Century Cities in their seeking relief from state laws preventing the expansion of broadband services to their residents. This decision is about more than these two communities. It's a major step forward for all communities seeking next generation internet to transform the way we learn, work, and live. Choice and competition are key ingredients to broadening the reach and opportunities afforded by this vital infrastructure. This decision is a win for local choice and a win for competition. It sets a powerful precedent nationwide that cities should be free to choose when it comes to high quality internet. So Next Century City stands ready to work with every city that believes in the importance of the internet for our future. So I believe this opens up a great opportunity for Yellow Springs to consider building out a municipal fiber network. And I might add that Columbus, Ohio is also a member of Next Century Cities.
Thank you.
Okay,
can you give your name, please?
Tim.
Oh, your name?
Oh, no. Tim Barwurst. I'm a citizen and member of the CAP panel, as well as the SpringsNet group.
And Tim, can people register for the forum now?
Oh, yellow-springs.net. There's a registration page.
Any other citizens' concerns for items that aren't on the agenda? Is it something that's not on the agenda, Bob?
Yes, it's
okay.
Not on the agenda.
Come on up.
I got a phone call last Saturday night. It was my son, and he was really hot. He said, "Dad, I own that apartment house on the corner of Elm and South Winter." He says, "I bust my can to get there early and make sure those sidewalks are clean all the way to Elm Street and then all the way up toward the Catholic Church. And he said, generally the snowplow covers the sidewalk on Elm Street because the sidewalk is at the curb. There's no grass in between. But he said, this is the first time, and he's owned it 7 years, I've owned it 25, that the sidewalks, because they are elevated about 24 inches, have been covered over with snowplow residue. And it is soaked, and this happens all over town. But he was really hot. He said, listen, we are on the same block as the Methodist Church. We are one block from the Catholic Church. These people need a safe walkway. Our whole town talks about walkability. I was at the Antioch Charette meeting last night at the college. There must have been 200 people there. Walkability is one of their big things. Now, we can argue who the hell pays for the sidewalk, but we have to agree that we cannot continue plowing onto sidewalks. There are only two answers. One is you have to lower your speed and you have to change your angle. Now, sometimes that's tough when you really, you know, and I have no complaints with the street crew particularly. They do a hell of a job. But someone has to be more careful on where this huge amount of snow goes. When it's piled up on the sidewalk, you cannot shovel it, especially if it's got any ice in it. Now, on Zing Avenue, I practice self-defense because I own the Human Center at 105 West North College. I own 716. I dropped my own plow right next to the curb. I plowed that damn curb all the way for about 4 blocks. So any sidewalk that has been shoveled is not going to be compromised, and it's worked out fine because it can be a state truck, it can be a county truck, it can be a Yellow Springs truck. I've never seen a Yellow Springs truck go on Zing Avenue and cover those sidewalks. But it is a problem. It can be solved. I think it's important that it is solved. That's it.
Yeah, the state put snow in my driveway that I had just finished shoveling yesterday.
That's unfortunate, but that homeowner, that's the homeowner's responsibility. The street crew cannot keep the drivel out of your walks and your driveways. You got that's a homeowner's responsibility.
Isn't that what you're asking?
What? No.
Isn't that what you're asking?
You're not listening. The damn sidewalk, the whole length of the sidewalk has got this much stuff from the street onto the sidewalk because the sidewalk is at the curb. Anybody that shovels that snow knows
Jason,
what I'm talking
Jason's
about.
Jason's here.
I did call your son, by the way, Mr. Baldwin, and we talked about it. Unfortunately, because of the amount of snow we have or had and trying to get it over, our plow unfortunately did push the snow back up on the sidewalk. Unfortunately, our bigger plows, Mr. Baldwin, do not angle. So there's only one way we can push it, and that's off to the right. So to get those parking stalls open, unfortunately, we pushed it up there, and I affirmed him that we would come out and do a better job.
Any other citizens' concerns? Next is special reports, the Community Access Panel annual report to council. That can be Paul.
Yeah, actually it's going to be Paul, who's our station manager, and also Forsage, the chair of the Community Access Panel. I think Paul's going to start us off. And by the way, you will notice all the names of the panel members are on the report.
Good evening. I'd like to read you the 14-page report. I won't cover very much here because others will follow. I'll talk about the station. We had a good year, lots of programs, but unfortunately not a lot of local programs, and we're looking for more content. Just had a communications with a person at the high school. We may be getting some more high school student prepared programs this coming year. Jane Payne has been our program manager for several years, and this year we had about 30 different programs throughout the week. some organizations in town which provided video, the James A. McKee Group, Home Inc., the Council Land Trust, and some others. And we're looking for more like that. Gene has gotten programs from other communities with public access through an organization called Peg Media. So we download their programs. This year we uploaded programs, 13, I believe, of the plays by the Yellow Springs Kids Playhouse. And they've been downloaded by many communities. In addition to airing our government meetings and these outside meetings, we also put DVDs in the library for checkout. And we put the government meetings on the village website. The website is going to be updated shortly, and we'll see how that goes. There were, Time Warner changed our channel a couple times in the last year, and I've heard some people no longer get our channel on public on their Time Warner. If you email the station or call me, my number's in the book, we'll try to get you back on the air. Next, who wants to speak next? Brian?
I think that's the word, yeah. Okay. Thanks, Paul.
Thanks, Paul.
Hi, I'm Thor Sage. I'm currently the chair of the Community Access Panel. Somewhat new initiative that we've taken on at the Community Access Panel is to evaluate the feasibility of new technology initiatives and opportunities that have been brought before the village relating to technology and infrastructure. Most notably, we're working to evaluate new initiatives associated with the development of fiber optic and wireless infrastructure in the village. This is a critical and relatively new function of the Community Access Panel across the country. As we heard from Tim Sparkhorse a few minutes ago, innovative municipalities are already recognizing the importance of leveraging gigabit level internet to attract new business and create jobs, improve health care and education, and connect residents to new opportunities. As part of this work, the Community Access Panel recommended to the council that the village become a member of the nonprofit advocacy group Next Century Cities. And as you may have heard, following the SEC's decision last week, Next Century Cities members now have won an important battle in protecting the rights of communities everywhere to make their own decisions about their broadband future. The development of local technology infrastructure is also important from a regional standpoint as well, as various organizations across the Miami Valley are actively engaged in developing their own infrastructure projects. As governments in Wilmington, Springfield, Fairborn, and Greene County, and elsewhere are planning fiber projects, it will become clear that our village must also fully evaluate the importance and value of its own infrastructure. In case you didn't hear also, the Miami Valley Educational Computer Association, where I'm employed, won a local government innovation fund loan to build a fiber optic network in the city of Wilmington. It is important to consider that publicly owned municipal fiber, fiber to the home, and wireless infrastructures can not only serve the community, but also can also support the operations of private businesses that might choose to locate in connected communities. It is of the utmost importance that our village is at the center of infrastructure development instead of being potentially bypassed by the networks that are growing throughout Southwest Ohio. In the coming weeks, the Community Access Panel will offer recommendations for Dig Once policies that will ensure that opportunities for the construction of conduit pathways will not be missed. And we'll continue to work on and deliver strong business plans for infrastructure development and new options for technology-related village offerings that will help our community grow more connected. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Brian. Brian, are you going
to
add anything?
Yeah, I did want to, first of all, say thanks to John Young for coming out and being an active part of the Community Access Panel. He's been to two meetings and been a vital piece of some of the things we're trying to do. The other thing is I want to give a big pitch for volunteers for the station. We have very few right now. Paul and Gene do a ton of work, and so they're always looking for folks as well as content. And we do have at least one, probably two spots on the community access panel. So if you're interested in how the station works, some of these initiatives related to municipal broadband, it's getting exciting. So thanks.
Thank you. And thanks for the report. You always provide a very detailed report. Thanks, Paul.
Did I notice that you have office hours from 10 to 12 every day?
Saturday.
Oh, just on Saturdays. Okay. So that's good to know. I didn't realize you had office hours. So 10 to 12 on Saturdays if you want to speak directly to somebody who's, or if you've got a problem and you just want to talk it out, or when you've got an idea.
Yeah, you can also use editing equipment, check out cameras. It's a great resource.
Next on the agenda is utility ordinance policy discussion regarding utility delinquencies. I will turn that over to Patty. This is a continuation. I think this is probably at least the third time this has been on our agenda.
Right. Many people are new, so right. Probably a little extra background of how we got to this, where's this coming from, so people are clear about the history.
Right. One of the things that Melissa Van Zandt found when she continued to comb through the financial records of the village was a large delinquency problem on some of the utility accounts. Many of them rural properties, but not all of them. Some of them are owner-occupied properties. Part of that was due to the policy that allowed that had the tenant responsible for the bill, and the way that policy was written and several of the loopholes in it. So council had asked that the staff look at the problem, bring various recommendations to them. We did that. Council asked us to draft a policy in using, I believe, three of the five recommendations. One was to make the landlords responsible for the bill. One was to allow it to be assessed to property taxes. And the third was, and I can't remember it off the top of my head. Here we go. Oh, the third was to close the loophole that said that anyone can have utilities reinstated to the property if there was still an outstanding bill associated with that property. To that end, we put together the policy recommendation that you have in your packets tonight. This is based on quite a bit of research. There is a survey out on the tables out there, and I believe also in your packets, of 33 municipalities in the state of Ohio, 25 of which hold the property owner responsible. And I know that that's a small sampling, but I'm fairly certain that if you did an even larger sampling of more people responding, you would probably have very similar percentage. It's also based on the Ohio Revised Code that allows the utility to hold the property owner responsible as well as assess it to the property taxes for the policy or for that account for that property. So
can you talk about, I know that the delinquencies have been longstanding and quite large, mm-hmm. to the point where a large percentage of it is just been wiped away. I mean, we can't collect it.
Right. Well,
so could
yeah.
you talk about current policy, what Melissa has done, what the utility department is doing to better collect these
right.
past dues?
The current policy requires that we send one delinquent notice to the person, whomever the account is in, whether that be the property owner or the tenant. That's all it really requires. The staff downstairs began about a year ago, year and a half ago, sending at least two delinquent notices and sometimes several more in an attempt to collect some of the past due bills. While the current policy does say that after, I believe, 7 years, we have to write it off, we've kept them there simply because many times that person does come back in and apply for utilities at a different property where they're renting, and we require them to pay the past due bill before we allow them to open an account for another property. We've also, they will work, write a payment plan for you if you're delinquent in your bills, but we will not continue to rewrite them over and over again, which has also been part of the problem. We will do it once. We will potentially do it twice if, you know, your circumstances change, but we will not continue to rewrite them over and over again.
And of those delinquencies, what's the percentage that of people that aren't, people that have left, that have essentially left that property?
Well, that's kind of hard to tell. And the reason that it's hard to tell is because the way that the policy is currently written, if you live at a property and the utilities are in your name and they get shut off, but there's another person who lives at the property, they can open the utilities in their name at the same property. So it's difficult to tell if that person still lives there and is still getting the benefit of the utilities and they're just in somebody else's name. So there's not really a way to be able to tell that.
Council, do we have any?
Could you remind me, we have tried working with collection agencies in the past. Am I correct in my memory?
Yeah. Well, according to Melissa, that the records do show that several years ago, the village did contract with a collection agency to try to collect some of that debt. And apparently that did not work out very well. They didn't do a very good job. They kept half of what they collected, which half of nothing is, you know, half of something is better than nothing, but for whatever reason, the contract was discontinued. And that was prior to mine and Melissa's.
What is the current deposit that we charge?
I know it's $100 for electric. Johnny, do you know what the utility, the water for Jason, the sewer? I think it's $100.
200 total.
200 total for electric, water, and sewer?
Yes.
And a lot of times that doesn't cover the last bill. If somebody is, especially if someone's on a payment plan and we've tried to work with them and they get behind on the payment plan and then they move out, that doesn't cover the bill.
Other questions from council?
Yeah. Well, just as a statement, first of all, sometime recently this year we initiated a credit card payment, right? So that I think has made, do you know whether that's made?
It has made a difference. I can't tell you what the percentage is, but more people are able to pay their bills with a credit card.
And they can do that, can they do that online and in person? Oh, okay, just in person.
Or call in, okay. Yes. Yeah. So we are working for online.
The question I have is, let's say, I just did get my bill, which is due on the 15th. So let's say I didn't pay it. Let's say I didn't pay it. So then when am I first gonna hear from you? And what? And if I don't come in and do a payment plan, when are you gonna cut off mine?
30 days. Your next bill that goes out is marked delinquent and you get 30 days. So essentially you get 2 months.
Okay, so it's due the 15th.
It's due the 15th.
So then the next month,
the bill that goes out, the bill that you'll get next month that you just received, that will be marked delinquent. 30 days from the 15th of this month, which makes it the 15th of April, you get shut off.
And what are the months that you're not allowed, or the times that you're not allowed to shut off
the electricity? The winter months, you're talking about the electricity?
Yeah, so is it based on the temperature?
It's based on the safety of the homeowner. So we can shut them off at any time. Our policy allows us to do so, but it's a safety issue.
Yeah, but we won't if it's
correct.
In general,
it's 5 degrees below, we're not shutting them
off. Well, let's say it's in the winter and they didn't pay that first month and they got that second and they didn't pay that. Would we shut off everything but the electricity?
Correct.
So they could be there with no water.
Correct.
Okay, so let me, I didn't understand. So the bill we just got is due March 15th. Somebody doesn't pay the March 15th bill.
They don't pay by the 15th of April, they get the school.
So, but they don't, so they don't even get a, they don't even get a delinquent bill?
They do, because the bill that, the bill that you just got this past weekend, the bill for February, which is your February bill.
Right.
The bill that goes out for March, that you get at the beginning of April, will be marked delinquent. So you'll get that.
So, okay, so it's April 15th, okay.
Right, and then they'll get shut off on the 15th.
Okay.
If they don't pay.
And do we actually do that?
Shut people off every month, unfortunately, yes. It is not, believe me, the favorite duty of our crew, but yes, we do do it.
Now, I know that there are a lot of people, I saw Joe's hand up, I know there are a lot of people here probably to talk about this. So Joe, are you, you need to go up to the podium.
I'm looking out and I see a lot of, I would appreciate if people have ideas on, you know, how this could be handled.
I was just wondering, in the dollar amount.
Can you state your name, please?
Oh, yes, it's Joe Dunphy. In dollar amount, how much are we delinquent right now? I mean, when we're talking about this, we don't have an idea of the total amount that the village is owed.
It depends on how far you go back. If you go back 25 years, which is what Melissa did, it's almost 500,000. If you go back 10 years, it's substantially less. I think it was 117,000. It depends on how far you go back.
Okay. And that's still on the books and
it does go back all the
time. Yes, ma'am.
That's what I wanted to know.
Thank you.
Thanks, Joe.
Thanks, Joe.
Betty?
Don't worry about that.
I'm a small property owner compared to Bob Baldwin and Joe Dunphy. But I do have rental property. I don't care for your proposals at all. I have an arrangement with Veteran that if they are ready to turn off the gas on one of my tenants, they inform me. I inform that tenant, you either pay or move. And this, the village should tell the landlord, don't charge us, but you could take the time to tell us.
Right, well that is one of the recommendations in our policy. Right?
Well, I don't think any landlord wants to pay the utilities for their tenants. So they're going to get on them, they're either gonna make them move or make them pay.
Right.
And the property is not decent, safe, and sanitary without it. So I'm proposing that the village, if you don't have the manpower with what we're losing, hire somebody send out the letters.
One of the recommendations in our policy is that we notify the landlord as soon as it goes delinquent. So that when the 15th of this month comes and they don't pay their bill, the landlord would get notified.
Has that been happening?
No, ma'am, it's not part of the policy right now because a lot of times the landlord isn't the person who signed up for the account.
Tell the landlord, don't charge them. Or don't put them on our property tax either. Or any of those three proposals that you suggested I don't go along with. I think there's a way to work it out. That's all I'm saying.
Sam?
I'm Sam Young. I have several things to say on this subject, and I'm not sure I can fit into 3 minutes, but bear with me. I'll try. Last week's Yellow Springs News stated, and I quote, the village has been losing about $22,000 annually in unpaid utility bills. Can someone tell me the total annual utility billings? It makes a big difference whether $22,000 is 20% of that or half of a percent of that. I can't tell without the total. That's the first thing. The next is, and this was partially addressed by council members a few minutes ago. At the February 17th council meeting, I heard all of these statements made by council members. This is the way it's done where Patty came from. Other communities do it this way. Many other communities do it this way. The majority of other communities do it this way. And the vast majority of other communities do it this way. Now, I understand there's a survey out there, and I will get a copy because I haven't seen it. I was going to ask for a list of communities surveyed and which communities are the other communities that do it this way. Now I would like to know, what is the selection criteria? Have these 33 or whatever it is communities been somehow pre-selected based on knowledge? Don't need to answer just now. Next, one of our council members has written that, and again I quote, there are enough delinquencies and outright failure to pay final bills that we can't continue to ask the entire community to pay for it. I would like to know the specific line of reason, the rationale, that makes it preferable to ask a much smaller group of our citizens pay for it. Another council member said, property owners should be held responsible if they're making money on their property. I would suggest that whether someone's making or losing money is irrelevant to this issue. The issue is who should pay for it, and are you really going to differentiate between money makers and money losers? If I'm losing money on a rental, are you going to give some money back to me? Yet another council member has said she would expect to be held accountable if tenants don't pay. But that council member owns a guest house and there's no tenancy created. I don't think they have the same risk. Another said that landlords have the option of including utility costs in the rent to avoid the possibility of default. I'd like to talk about that possibility. Most tenants are honest and pay their bills, that we know. But if you have a tenant who wants to escape their final bill, the chances are they also want to escape their final month's rent. Now, if you're a landlord and a tenant doesn't pay the rent when it's due, what do? The first thing you do is wait a few days until you see if it's been held up in the mail. If the check doesn't arrive, you make a phone call. Then you hear, oh, I've been sick and I lost my job. I'll get it to you by the 15th. So you wait until the 15th. Check still doesn't come. So you call again and you get the same story. And maybe you wait another 10 days and maybe you initiate eviction procedures. How long do eviction procedures take? Well, I don't know. Maybe our solicitor can help us with this. But my guess is it takes 60 or 90 or sometimes even longer. By the time the process is over, the landlord has already lost 3 or 4 months' rent. And now you want us to lose the utilities too. Maybe the landlord has a mortgage on the property. All this time the money's going out with none coming in. The tenant is still in the house or apartment and maybe still has utility service. And now I'd like to talk for just a moment about commercial leases.
Please let him finish. He's making a point for all of us.
But Millworks tenants often make substantial improvements to our buildings and in return they expect long-term leases. You can put extra costs on us with a stroke of your pen. We sometimes can't even get a little more deposit for 7 or 8 years. I think it's time we got serious about this. If we pass this, rents are going to go up. But I guess we can subsidize another group to create affordable housing.
My name is Michael Greitzer. Council member McQueen mentioned something earlier about accepting credit cards. Just to make a very brief point, when someone walks into the village office and presents $200, you grant them utilities. People that own properties go through a selection process that is far more in-depth. Credit checks, background checks. We don't accept everyone that applies for rental. If you're accepting credit cards, take a deposit with a credit card, take a credit card number, and finish the utility account with that credit card at the end of their residency, instead of adding it back to the landlord's property.
Other comments? John?
John, I don't know if you folks got my letter, mm-hmm. but
great. I don't have any great solutions to the problem. It is a problem. But my thought first is that the village is in business to provide utilities. It is a business. It is a function. It's a business. And you sign a contract with the tenant, with the person. So that's a legal, I assume, a legal, legally binding contract. And landlords or whoever else is not a party to that contract. So how you can bring somebody that's not a signatory to that contract in and make them responsible, I just find it difficult to understand how you do that. I would encourage the village to be more forth, what's the word? Forthwith or foregoing in going after delinquent payments and doing it more forcefully and not thinking that they're a social service or a social organization. You're a business, and so you should function as a business, not a social worker.
Thank you, John.
Sorry, I can't.
Other comments?
Hello, my name is Yanni Latus. And first off, I'd like to point out on just legally, under the Ohio Revised Code section that you're looking at, it only applies to water rents. So if you're considering doing this for electric bills as well, I don't think you have the authority to do so under the Ohio Revised Code. And a couple suggestions that I think would make sense, because this is a big step, to put bills on a landlord that are for a tenant, is one, a collection agency. You said you tried a few years ago. I think it would be worth trying again. So we're talking about $22,000 a year. I think a collection agency could greatly reduce that amount. Another thing you could try is to slightly increase the deposit amount. So I think even a slight increase could have a very large effect on the amount of collections that you get. Another thing you could do, and someone else mentioned, is so as far as notice is concerned, right? If you wait a whole month to give them notice that it's delinquent, right, that gives them a lot more time to say, hey, I can get 2 months off and not have to pay my utility bill. If you give that notice, say, 10 days after and turn it off within a shorter period of time, that's going to get a lot more people to pay and really reduce that amount. So just three quick suggestions that I think are worth trying before we take this very large step to charge landlords for bills that they didn't sign on for. So, thank you.
Thank you. Other comments? Dean?
Hi, my name's Dino Pallotta. I'm a renter, a business owner, property owner, and a landlord. We've heard three things here, what we've all said. Collection agencies, I was in firm agreement. I've written it down here. We gotta try harder. I mean, you tried one collection agency, we had an issue with it. There's a lot out there. It's gonna be beneficial. Number two, we all entered into contracts. I signed up, we all signed up for contracts with the village. That's a big issue for me. We were responsible for our bills. You're responsible to collect. I would expect that would take place, that on your part, that you should be, you're responsible for going after those who don't pay. To really get to the crux of this, if you're looking to get the property owners, the property taxes, the properties themselves, or the landlords, you're gonna have to look at this cause and effect. For every action, there's gonna be a reaction, and they're gonna react. And that's gonna be in one of three ways. Number one, credit apps are going to come in, and they're going to be looked at much more stringently. You're going to be looked at a lot harder. You're going to go for a higher based credit person that's more credit worthy. Number one. Number two, a landlord is not going to expose himself. There is just no way a landlord is going to expose himself to this type of a liability without any repercussions. It's just not going to happen. It's just carrot and stick. So you're going to get higher rents. That's going to come down because they're going to protect ourselves. Number three, we're going to start taking higher deposits on the units. And lastly, we're going to start taking deposits on the utilities, which we haven't done before. So that's going to again put more of a burden on the renter that they have to be fairly well off, that they got to come in with some cash up front just to get into the village. Now, what's going to come down to the bottom line is this, is that you're going to start shrinking the type of renters, the type of people that you want in the village. It's not going to be an affordable village anymore. You're going to really start pushing people out as opposed to bringing people in. And that's the cause and effect that's going to come out of this. Because it's just, it's a business. It's strictly business. On your side of the business to collect the monies, it's on our side of business that we want to protect our property. We want to make our money. We want to protect what's there. We want to give a viable place for a renter. So all this comes hand in hand, that it's going to be full circle. And those are the things that you have to consider before you're going to go to this stick and say, landlord, property owner, you must pay now. It's just not going to, you're going to have another side effect to this. And I hope you're taking that into account as you go along with this.
Thanks, Lee. Other comments? John?
John Edwards, my comment is a question, and it's a much more simplistic one. Normally, we get the bill at the beginning of the month. Let's say that I have been consistently on time and paying my bill. However, if I'm not here at the beginning of the month or on the 15th of the month, what's going to happen in terms of that utility payment?
You mean as far as the amount of it?
No, as far as being considered to be delinquent.
If it goes past the 15th of the month, it's considered to be delinquent, but you won't get shut off for 30 days past that. You'll get a late charge on your bill for paying late, but you won't get shut off for 30 days past that 2 days.
The reason I'm asking this question is that I'm going to be up in Cleveland having surgery the end of April. I probably will not be back until the end of May. Is there a way that I can prepay?
Sure, you can go ahead and pay an extra amount and have that credit sit on your account, and when your bill, it would be applied to your bill. So if you have an idea of what your bill normally is, then yes, you can pay ahead on that account, and then when your bill gets put on there, that amount will come.
So if you don't pay the full amount because you don't know what that full amount is, you're not going to be considered delinquent because you didn't know what the complete amount was.
This is really very detailed. This is really something that you should talk to the utility department.
Yeah,
this isn't the same issue at all.
Right. Why don't you let me have Melissa give you a call, okay, and she can help you with it.
Thank you. Somebody over here had a hand up. Bob?
Do I have to talk into the microphone?
There isn't.
Oh, boy.
There isn't a working
one.
We find a word when you
can. The gentleman spoke two turns ago. I agree with 100%. He's done his homework. It is going to change the mix in the village as these costs get passed on. Couple comments. 33 municipalities were canvassed. I don't think more than one is in the electric business. Nobody's in the electric business. They all gave it up except Yale Springs. They are talking about water. I went down the list. They were all water people. So I think there is a difference between water and so forth. What I'm really asking for is due diligence by the village. It has not been done for years. Due diligence means you send out a bill, you're given a grace period of 30 days. No, you're not. You're given basically 15 days to pay. We mailed out the first. It's due the 15th. You had, 5% late fee, which could be considerable if you're really $22,000 a year delinquent. And then, if I heard right, you're giving another 30 days before you talk about notifying land. That's too damn long.
No.
15 days is plenty. If it's due the 15th, it's not there, they're delinquent. At the end of the month, that's 15 more days, you notify the landlord, if you're going to do this, and you notify the tenant, your electricity, your utilities will be cut off X. Now, I have Section 8 apartments because some of my tenants came down with cancer. They couldn't work. So I have Section 8. My son has Section 8. It's worked out fine. And I go to their monthly meetings. And they just tear your heart out, because most of the people that are mom and pop landlords, they've got a double here, they've got a rental unit there. God, they're taken advantage of by the tenants, the dogs, the discretion, so forth. The comment I want to pass in, a guy that runs probably 100 units, he stood up and said, hey, are you in the business to run a hobby or a business? He said, if you're running a business, for crying out loud, run it like a business. Village, you've got computers, you've got staff, you've got to know, if you even consider this, and I don't agree with it particularly, but if you even consider it, then you have a job to do for due diligence, that person is notified, and then how are you going to cut them off? This is a caring community. It's part of the Yellow Springs mystique. People are going to want to string out these bills. You cannot do it. You can say, we've got Starfish, we've got agencies around to give support, but you cannot dribble this damn bill along. You know, $50 a month, $50. They're never going to get caught up. You cannot do business like that. And as long as the renters know that they can get away with it, they will. You know that, and I know that. It's a bad policy, and I think it's unnecessary if the village would do due diligence. After a reasonable time, you need a month and a half for a deposit, number one, because it takes another half month to get the notice. If you do your job, this will not be a problem. The problem is, how do you handle the widow? Someone lost their job, someone had surgery. I can't pay it. We have to help them get pointed to some agency to bail them out. The village should not be in the bail.
Got it, Bob.
Okay.
I saw a hand up over here.
My name is John Cannon. I know some of you have thought that it's natural that landlords should pay, and I do see a situation in which it is. And short-term rental. And short-term rental is not time to sign up. The landlord's right on hand anyway. The rent is high enough that the utilities come to maybe about 3% of the rent. It's no big deal. Then it's appropriate for the landlord to handle it. They're gone in a week or two, and they paid a high rent to stay around for short-term. In the long-term rental, somebody leases the house, they're there for 3 years. The landlord is out of the picture, so I can pay taxes and insurance and coming over to fix things, but basically out of the picture. And after 3 years, you expect them to something get a bill from the village that you owe for the utilities, they're not in the picture. Now you might as well say, okay, the landlord provides a refrigerator, so I suppose the market should send up the landlord's bill because the landlord provided the refrigerator and they got some food and put it there. I don't think anybody could even dream of that. The landlord provides some wiring, and it makes a contract with the village. That's where the deal is. It's not the landlord's business. And this is notification. I mean, the landlords are going to be calling in every month to make sure all their tenants are right up. They're not going to wait that extra 30 days. You're going to have a lot of telephone calls to the utility department. It doesn't make sense to do it.
Thank you. Any other comments? A lot of questions.
Paul is,
I'm sorry, Paul.
I won't repeat what I said last council meeting or what my wife said last council meeting. I'll second whatever was said to you tonight and repeat one thing. The rents will go up. There are tools you can use. You gave up one was very effective. You had a collection agency, and the renters or the deadbeats didn't like it. That was great. Do it again. Then they'll pay their bill. There are other things you can do. If there's a big bill and you do sock the landlord, give them the landlord the same discount you give collection agencies. Half the price. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. Anything else? There were some questions that I think we could probably answer.
One of the things I would like to clarify is the landlord would be notified as soon as the bill goes past due. It would not wait 30 days. If it's the 5th of the month comes and they don't pay their bill, the plan that we have is on the 6th of the month to start notifying you by May. So that's the plan. We would not wait the 30 days. The landlord would be notified immediately that bill's past due. You would know before the 15th of the month, you know, or before the next bill came out.
That's what I want.
So I should have said the bill's due on the 15th. You would be notified the 16th. Okay, so that's the plan. It's not to make you wait the 30 days. They don't get another bill marked delinquent for 30 days until the next bill goes out. But the landlord would not wait that long. As far as the survey itself, the way that was sent out, it was sent out by someone in Xenia, excuse me, I believe it was the clerk in Xenia, who sent it out to an email group, and it was just sent out to blanket everybody in the group and asked the question, how do you handle utility delinquencies? It was a general question. It wasn't anything specific. There were not specific people who were chosen, and the results that all of the results that were received are out there. So,
was that water or electric? That's all.
It was probably water.
It was
water and sewer, I believe,
okay.
Because
water,
most of these communities don't have electric.
Right.
A few of them do.
Yeah, a few of them do. Most of them are water and sewer.
And Xenia only has water and sewer, so I would assume that that's what they were looking for, an equivalent. And I will say that actually even the two communities who said that they didn't have the policy of making the landlord responsible actually said that they don't turn the utilities back on again for a new tenant until the bill has been paid, if there is an outstanding balance. So that's essentially making the landlord responsible. And that is a situation that happened in the city of Dayton.
I thought you responded when the credit card issue, adding on in the end, did you say that's not possible?
Right. I do not believe that we are allowed to keep your credit card number on file. That's why you have to call us every month with it. We can't keep it in your file and say, charge you every month.
Absolutely. Are you allowed to bill in advance instead of arrears?
Hold on. Chris, are you aware of that? Is that something?
On the ability to hold a credit card, this
yes.
deposit? I don't know the answer off the top of my head.
Okay.
So we'll be sure to research
that. That will be something to research.
We'll make sure to research that.
The credit card thing is not worth researching because they'll just cancel the credit. Now, I have really two questions. One of your options, clearly, is to sell the electric utility to somebody like DBNF.
The issue is water and sewer. We're also talking about water and sewer,
yeah,
and we're not selling those.
Yeah.
Are there other? I think Patty was kind of going systematically through it. One question that was asked was the 22,000. What was that number out of?
I haven't researched that.
So we'll be sure to research that before the next meeting.
And the other things that I wrote down were just some of the suggestions.
And I remember at the first meeting there was a graph or a chart that was included.
Correct.
Showing the delinquencies over time.
Correct.
And I would like, I mean, this is an ongoing discussion. We don't have legislation yet. We're discussing, and we haven't even asked to have legislation brought yet. So one thing I would like some research done on collection agencies. Understand what percentage they charge, how they go about.
And that was one of the five suggestions that Melissa had brought was a collection agency, but council had indicated they wanted to look at the other three first. So
I can address the collection agency generally. Typically, there's one rate charged if the collection is made without the initiation of litigation, which is typically a third, or what could be more, and then up 50% if they have to file, and then costs would be excluded from whatever that recovery is. So effectively, it's a contingent fee relationship.
So you could give the landlords all those benefits too.
was kind of reluctant to do the shut-off because of safety issues for the crew. But if you're going to send me a notice, well, in the past, I guess, let's say that recent past, it's been an issue for me as a landlord. And so if you're going to notify me in a timely manner, am I going to have the ability to say, shut it off? And secondly, who's going to pay for the reconnect? Are you going to charge me as a landlord if I'm shutting it off to protect my interest? Because I don't want to have a bill accrued?
I believe the landlord-tenant law says that if you have somebody in there, you can't have it shut off until it's the time we would normally shut it off. I believe the landlord-tenant law prohibits you from doing that. That's what I was told at my other position.
No, but I mean, if you're notifying me that my tenant is delinquent,
correct,
in order to address the issue and not incur further damage, you know, are you not going to react if I say, turn the service off?
I don't think we can, Chris, do you?
You're telling me you're going to hold me accountable for something, but I am not requiring the service anymore.
The answer is that I would assume that a landlord, in these communities where the owner is responsible, the leases in those communities create a condition of default if there is a non-payment of a utility, and that translates to whether or not the landlord can give 3 days notice or 30 days notice.
Right.
Because typically the 3-day notice only applies to a condition of rent, and I think someone mentioned how long does it take to evict. With a 3-day notice, if that situation is not rectified, I would expect that there would be a writ of restitution of the premises going to Xenia Municipal Court probably within 10 days.
3 weeks.
Is it 3 weeks how long it takes? Kind of surprises me that it's that long. But if the lease were written and so that the default tacked back to a condition of the payment of rent, then I think a 3-day notice could be served. But to answer Patty's question, if the policy of the village is 30 days delinquency and then you have another 30 days in which to bring the account current or to set up a payment plan, my recommendation off the top of my head would be that I don't think that the village could terminate the utility service at that point. But I'd want to look at that to make sure.
So the other question I guess I have is, are you planning to not allow tenants to sign up for the service and that the service would ultimately always be in the owner's landlord's name? Or are you saying it is the owner's risk to say, go ahead and sign up, but if you don't pay, we're still going to bill you anyway?
I believe that Chris's recommendation, and I would agree with it, is that the account stay in the landlord's name. The bill can be sent to the tenant if that's what you choose. You as the landlord would have the choice to either receive the bill yourself or have it go to the tenant. But the account itself would be in the property owner's name.
So logistically, just to give you an idea of what that would involve for someone like me, I manage for several people, and I own property myself, okay? So I manage for other owners. So at that point, would you be leaving it in the owner's name or the property manager's name?
It's the property owner's name.
Okay, so my owners that live in Seattle would have the utility bill in their name, and then it would be sent to me.
Logistically,
you guys need to think about what's going to happen when you eliminate the ability for someone that's paying the bill, that's actually responsible for the bill, to do that. And it's going to tie a lot of people's hands. And I am afraid that because of that logistics, it will create higher costs because people will be afraid they're going to be put on the hook. And I think if you screen prior to giving service, like the landlords do, I mean, do you screen? Do you run a credit check?
I mean, I guess I would assume that if you guys are,
can I say one more thing and then I'm done? So if you're not running a credit check, Vectren has a standard where they run a credit check and they build the deposit based on the person's credit history. So if somebody comes in and has an impeccable credit history, they pay a very low deposit. If somebody walks in and they have a derogatory credit history, their deposit is
maybe five times what the average bill would be, because Vectren has a stake in whether they're paying. So if you just ran a simple credit check on your utility customer, and again, a credit check is $2 through CVC credit.
Include it in the deposit.
You might have a better idea of who's going to pay you and who isn't, because you would see that they haven't paid their other utility companies, like I do.
Vectren, under PUCO regulations, can charge commercial customers 125% of the highest 3 months of use. And I think residential is 2 months of the highest use. So typically that would be January in either February or December. But it's not necessarily scaled. They do have discretion, but that's the max they can charge.
But you would agree with me that they can charge based on credit history, and they do in fact increase the deposit based on drawing.
They are capped at what they can charge.
But they do increase it based on the credit.
I wouldn't use the word increase. They might decrease it based upon certain factors.
Okay,
but but there's a cap on what they can request on the deposit.
Well,
that's the village have the ability to run credit checks. Is that?
I would assume we have my question would be, do we have the ability to run credit checks? My question would be, could we deny them service?
That's what I mean.
Based on credit checks. Yeah, I wrote it down to check on that because I'm not sure that we could or couldn't.
With Vectren, didn't you say they don't deny, they just charge.
They don't deny.
They
don't give you the bigger deposit.
Or they will require cosigners.
Yes.
There you go.
Sam?
I don't know if this is legal, but it seems to me the whole problem would go away if you could bill in advance instead of in arrears.
Well, what level billing kind of is?
Well, if you just charge an amount based on past usage, if they use less, take the little bit of difference and apply it to the next month and be billing them for the month in advance all the time.
Well, essentially we do that anyway, because you get an estimated bill for 2 months, and then you get caught up every third month.
Then it must be legal. Yeah.
So it's similar to, I mean, that's essentially what we do. We essentially do level billing on all of our utilities.
Well, I don't think that's level billing. You might follow a pattern for the, I mean, that's not necessarily level.
Right.
But it just seems to me that the whole problem goes away at that point. People are paying ahead of time instead of after the time.
Council, what information are we interested in bringing to the next meeting? And I definitely want Melissa to come to the next meeting to address this. I really do believe that we expected her for this discussion.
I think, you know, the folks out in the audience, they have had some real good questions. And I think we need to, as council and staff, need to go back and research those questions, okay? Also, I'm sitting there and I'm somewhat confused now because, you know, the delinquencies that we're talking about, is it both electric and water, but we're just looking at what we're gonna do about water? Because,
correct.
You know, because to me, that's a, you know, I think I heard a figure like 22,000 a year, that's a heck of a lot of people being delinquent on just water.
The delinquency that we're talking about is all utilities, because it's a combined bill. So when we talk about delinquency, we're talking about all utilities.
But in our policy, we're looking at just water. I'm reading it, because it's everything I keep reading talks about water. It's not talk about electric. So that's why I'm saying I'm a little bit confused now.
That's the entire bill.
Yeah. The statute that we cited for the authority that shows that there is a lawful basis by which landlords can be made responsible, owners of property can be made responsible. That was an example of what the statute said. It would apply to the other utilities, and we can get that authority.
Yeah, can you get that authority for us?
There were different rules on electric turnoff versus water. Clear, right, the policy all the time. But again, you know, I think that's a good comments for us to go back and
because I really believe that, you know, if we as council and staff have not done due diligence to collect the delinquencies, then, you know, that falls back on me. And for me now to say it's on you, yes, it's kind of hard to stomach if what I have done just doesn't work, okay? But I'm not sure that I've done enough now to say that it doesn't work and it needs to go back.
Well, those that are 25 years old, you got to ride it off anyhow, don't you?
Related to the issue of credit checks, because that was something I thought about too, I'd like to understand, you know, when sort of all these things we're talking about, what is going to be the cost, you know, in terms of just, you know, time and staff? Because we're talking about lots of different levels of notifications and things, and so we've got to have some kind of balance there.
Mary Ann, any other comments or questions?
First, I would like to address the issue about that I have a guest house, because I was the person that referred to. Before I had a guest house, I rented, and I'm closing the guest house this year in a few months, so I will be making more. So that's why I felt like I could speak from a landlord's point of view. In terms of things that I noted, one was, can we shorten the period that before we cut off, if that's one thing. And then several people mentioned that they believe that rents will increase. So I'm wondering if we can contact some of these other communities and find out, well, one, did they change the policy or has it always been that way? And if they changed it in some recent period of time, did that have an impact on rents? And I guess, this is a mutual thing. Properties wouldn't be very valuable if we didn't have utilities to serve them. And clearly, it's important that we have rental places in town. And at the same time, I don't think that it's fair that the village has to eat it all. So, I mean, I think whatever we can do to make it most workable for everyone, we want to figure out. I guess one other thing that it seemed like maybe Bob was sort of implying is for people who are really having a difficult time, I mean, something's happened, they got sick or whatever, is there any source of funding that will help pay?
Have we looked at PIP yet?
We haven't looked at PIP yet, but we do have a list of agencies down there that do assist people in paying their utility bills, and we make it available when people come in and they have problems paying their bills and give them all the contacts. So we do have that information down there.
And maybe that kind of information is something that landlords should have and that people should have right up front, right? Before they,
right.
It's very accessible.
But Brian, your answer about PIP is generally that's an even billing kind of a thing anyway, and a regular assistance thing that they have to apply for with an agency to get a regular assistance.
Okay. Well,
I would like Melissa to look into the background checks for the deposits and what kind of deposit we should be charging. Is it, I think $200 is obviously not been enough. What would be a typical, like what would we need to kind of average? What would be an average 2 month bill, for instance?
Exactly.
Would that be sort of, what would be a, how do we figure out what would be a good amount to kind of be shooting for our, for the deposit? Because regardless, we're going to need to have deposits, and I think clearly our deposits have not kept pace with what we need to be charging. And I think that's probably my suggestion. My suggestion is that we probably end discussion now, but people should write to us. We're not discussing ordinance. We're not even there yet. We're going to be having at least one more discussion, probably more than one discussion before we're even at the ordinance place. It's likely that the ordinance will look a little different than this. So my suggestion is if you could put your
one more thing, I think, just to fairly evaluate this. I mean, we're talking about 75% of the municipalities that we got information from do have this. And I guess there was one, I think Oakwood kind of explained their rationale, but I would just like to understand, you know, why so many municipalities do this.
It was really more than 75%. If you put in the other two that said no, they don't, but they don't turn on utilities back on for a new user, if there's a delinquency, they put it on the property taxes. Ultimately, the property owner is responsible. So I would say it's more like 90%. I would also like to have Melissa look into what the AMP communities are doing with their electric, because this particular survey is water and sewer. I agree with, you know, Lori about, and you know, how we would set up deposits, the possibility that deposits would be set up based upon, you know, by property as opposed to just, you know, because some properties, you know, highly energy efficient properties are going to not be using the amount of utilities. So should they be paying a premium? So I would, and I think, you know, if this does have an effect on affordability and on rents, I think it is something we have to take into consideration. We've taken that into consideration in other issues. And this idea of spreading out burden to the entire community. I mean, our motivation here has been the equity of the entire village paying for the delinquencies on a few properties. And what's the equity there? So we have to look at kind of comparing those two levels of equity and the redress. I mean, the village is not, yes, we are in the business of collecting utilities. We're clearly not making a lot of profit on these utilities. I mean, we're basically in the business of providing service to our citizens, not charging a lot of money for utilities. We're there to maintain and provide the service. So we're not making profit. We're not a DP&L. We are, you know, we don't have other ways to make profit on our utilities either. So I think we've got a lot of stuff for Patty to bring back. I think we probably will have this at the next meeting to continue with the continuity. So I hope you all come back to the next meeting.
The only thing I would say is, though, if it is a burden, and if you can't provide the complete service of the utilities, why do you do it? If you can't run it like a business and you cannot provide it and execute it and complete the process of provide the service, bill it, and collect it, it doesn't seem fair that you create a revenue stream and then you leave us to collect it.
Thank you. We'll end this discussion. Next on the agenda is the sidewalk discussion. We're calling the meeting back to order. The next item on the agenda is a discussion of sidewalk policy. We have an extensive report from our street superintendent, Jason Handy, and he is standing at the podium. And I do want to thank him for all the work that he did in getting council chambers together so quickly. So on another subject, but go ahead and report on the sidewalk.
Okay, what I've put together is an informational packet for council. The first page is something that we talked about a month and a half ago, I think it was, so I won't pay much attention to that. I'm going to start on page two. In 2010, village manager Mark Cunniff originally proposed an amount of $660,000 to fix existing sidewalk issues. So I took that number and added in the inflation rate of today from 2010 to 2015, and that figure would make it a little over $716,000 to only fix what is in need of fixing. The other thing I did was I went out and measured every sidewalk we have in the village. And after,
you are nothing if not thorough.
After collecting that data, I have determined that we have approximately 90,784 linear feet of sidewalk, which is a little over 17 miles. within our corporation of Yellow Springs. So what I've done is taken that number, the 90,784, times the 5-foot minimum width of the sidewalks, and that's where you come up with 453,920 square feet of sidewalks. The 5-foot minimum is a requirement by the U.S. Department of Transportation. Keep in mind, please, that most of our sidewalks are not 5 foot. So. So what I've done is taken that 453,000 overage and entered into a cost calculator of our area to see what it would cost per linear foot, or per square footage, to rehabilitate all of our sidewalks within the village. And that is the first, that is the first chart that you guys have, is to install new concrete sidewalks throughout.
So that's the 1.8 million to 2.4 million?
Yes. The 1.8 million is the low figure, which is equivalent to $4.10 a square foot. And then the high would be $5.31 a square foot. However, when I talked to a couple contractors here in our area, it's going to be more like $6 to $9 a square foot, even $12 a square foot.
Well, where did you get the 410 and the 531?
The old numbers.
The cost calculator.
From Cousins numbers, is that? No, the $4.10, that's what you would get for the 1.8 million.
Did they pay for the cost calculator on the internet?
Yes, yes. This was all entered into a cost calculator on the internet.
Based on our geographical area?
Based on the 4537.
And did the higher numbers come from people who have done work on our sidewalks?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Some of them have gone up to $12, which I thought was a little high, but that's just a side note of it. I think it's a little low, the number that they use for the calculator. So what that basically does is it breaks down the cost of the sidewalk, meaning the materials, the labor, and everything, and then that's where you get your final numbers. The figures above, they show what it would be to repair or rehabilitate all the sidewalks. Please keep in mind that this does not, it's putting a Band-Aid on an artery, so to speak, because you're only fixing, I mean, you need to fix what's there. So basically, the other thing that I need to point out here is that it doesn't account for all the preliminary work that we have to do to make these sidewalks uniform. And like I mentioned, unfortunately, that is talking about inappropriate trees. Commercial Court would probably be our best, because we just visited that. So Mercer Court has 5,250 square feet out of that 453,000, and is by far our worst things of concrete. So what I went and did is we would have to take out the 19 trees that are currently there for the sidewalks to be uniform and have the most life out of.
So those costs that we just went through are strictly the concrete themselves and the labor.
It's the concrete, the labor, the materials and supplies. Yes.
And so then what, as we go forward, what are these other numbers?
The other numbers are is if we fix what was proposed in 2010. And as mentioned, that's a little over 716,000 in today's market that we need to do. So basically what we would be looking at is only fixing 134,500 square feet of that 453.
So that would be
say there's a section of, I think on Xenia Avenue, when we did the east side of Xenia Avenue, we ended down to Herman. We ended up basically taking up everything, or we did, or we just put in squares where
we're just putting in squares.
And so is that what this second estimate would be?
Yes.
Is just putting in squares where the first one would be if we took everything out and put it back in again?
Put it back in properly.
And that doesn't address new construction? That doesn't address the construction of new sidewalks?
Not this number, no.
Okay.
Nope. This is only taking the squares out that need rehabilitation.
And that 716 is also based on these two low numbers, right?
Yes. Yes, so what I've done is entered the numbers into the same calculator, which I've done, and the high price is $714,000.
If we could actually get it for $5.34.
If we could do it for that amount. However, like I said, talking to a couple of local contractors, it's going to be more between 6 and 9. That was the average.
So I have a question. Thanks for hearing. So at the high end, it looks like almost $2.5 million to totally replace our sidewalks.
If we can get it out of that price point of $5.31.
And does that include putting sidewalks in places where it would be good to have them, but they don't exist?
No. What I have taken is only what's currently inventoried.
So
if there's a section of sidewalk that's not there, like take for instance Winter Street. Winter Street is, it runs about 3/4 of the way and then it just dead ends. I have not accounted for that.
In West Lawrence.
Yeah, there's a lot around town that they're basically sidewalks to nowhere.
So we could be getting up to like 4 million pretty.
Yeah. And well, and like I said, going back, if it does come out at $9 a square foot, you're looking at $4 million already.
How many sidewalks are you planning on West South College to be?
West South College is two sidewalks and not the bike way. This does not account for the bike way on Avenue, Dayton, or South College.
Do you know how much we paid square for the sidewalk squares that were repaired around the school last year?
I don't know off the top of my head.
I thought it was $6 or something.
I don't remember off the top of my head because some of them had to be widened as well. But I can get you that number.
I'm just saying that would give us a better idea of how much it really is going to cost, would cost,
yeah,
per square. Because that was done in the fall, so not so long ago.
Yeah. But I can get you that figure. I don't know off the top of my head.
Jason, your budget levy breakdown, could you explain that a little bit?
Yes. Basically, what I've done is taken into account if this goes to a 5-year levy breakdown, how much it's going to cost us each year to rehab these sidewalks. Because the $50,000 that's been allocated is not getting us much of anywhere. So this is more of a cost analysis of what it would cost per year for the next 5 years for us to rehab these totally. And then what it would cost for us to rehab just the existing issues.
So Jason, if I read it correctly, you've got a figure here that talks about new sidewalks, and then you've got the figure here of repairing the existing sidewalks.
Yes.
So, I'm just trying to make sure I look at it. So if we look at just repairing the existing sidewalks, if you look at the 110 roughly, and if we're talking about new sidewalks, we'd be looking at 300 to 700K.
Yeah, that's a low end.
It seems like we should be, if based upon the $6 idea, we should probably just not even consider looking at the 410 square foot. We should be looking at minimum the 531 square foot.
Yeah. And so what these budget numbers are is a direct feed off of what the two previous pages.
And do we know what this, has Melissa looked at this at all just to tell us what levy amount, what millage of levy this would be?
I don't think so, because Jason didn't get it really completely done until last Friday, I believe.
Yeah, I mean, my personal thinking is that we're somewhere in between here. You know, I don't see the point of pulling up decent sidewalk squares to put down new. So, I mean, I think the priority is repairing what is broken and heaved and needs to be repaired, and then filling the gaps, the literal gaps where there aren't sidewalks. You know, then when we've got whole streets where there aren't sidewalks that there probably should be, that's a whole nother story. I mean, that's a whole nother level of what we need to look at. And I think we do require new construction to put in their own sidewalks. So there's a level of inequity. If we are talking about a levy, what are we going to do about new construction? Is that going to include new construction? Because, you know, that would be a situation where those homeowners alone would be paying for their sidewalk, but no other homeowners would be paying for their sidewalk.
Another question for you, Jason. And I just happened to plow West South College, and some of the sidewalks look like they're only 3 feet wide. Some of them might have been 4. I didn't see any as 5. So if we were talking about repairing, if the requirement is 5 feet, then we're going to have,
as soon as you touch that sidewalk,
you got to do the whole thing.
Right.
Because you need to be out of compliance.
Yes.
So there's the trees. I mean, most of those, you know, are we going to go to the street? Are we going to just, you know, take it equally on both sides or take it towards the street? Then we're destroying the tree lawn.
But even if we're looking at homeowners, they would be in that same predicament.
Right.
You know, if you're asking me to repair mine, I would have to repair it the same. So I would have a whole section. Okay. The next person beside me. So to me, it'd be a rippling effect down the street. Everybody, if they have one broken piece, then the whole section of the curb. I'm asking.
You're correct. You're correct, because as soon as you touch that sidewalk, like Karen was saying, if we replace what is currently broken, if we were to take a section out, you have to do the whole stretch. So like say around the Mills Lawn, if Elm Street wasn't 5 foot, some of the spots were 4 foot, but however, the rest of that sidewalk was 5, we had to make it 5. We couldn't put it back as 4. So there was, I want to say like maybe 8 squares on that section down towards the tennis courts that we had to put almost in uniform because they were not steered.
Now, I mean, in most types of construction, if you're just doing a repair, you don't have to bring the building up to ADA standards. I'm really, are you absolutely positive that with sidewalk, you can't just replace one square of sidewalk?
If it's 4 foot, you can't put 4 foot back.
Required. I
that regulation. It also should have provisions for sidewalks as well.
Can you do some research on that?
I can do that.
I mean, it feels like still another part of this, though, is you know, maybe translating this, and maybe we're not ready to do this, maybe we don't need to go into detail, but, you know, translating this idea of where we don't have sidewalk, where we need the infill, and where the real damage is. I mean, but I will say that this thing, this 5 foot, if everything has to go back in at 5 foot, that totally changes the game. Then there's literally no repair. There's no ability to repair a square sidewalk. A whole sidewalk has to be. And so, I mean, that changes. That's not something I was even thinking about. So that
there's not even actually room for.
Yeah, I mean, we would be looking at probably right away. I mean, yeah, I mean, the whole issue. We'd be taking out trees everywhere. I mean, it would. So we've got it. That's something. That's something we've got to check on.
Some of this similar sort
can
of
can you make sure that, yeah.
There may be a similar.
Can you introduce yourself? I know it's really annoying, but it really is helpful to keep things actually fair and equitable. We have something close to a semblance of Robert's Rules of Order. So I don't want to be a stickler about it, but it really is actually fair to everybody that people aren't just shouting out and saying things whenever they want. There's a reason you have to be recognized by the chair of the meeting.
Just following on that point, Dan Reyes, that point that Karen was just making, I want to say this is about the compliance and conformity. There may be a number of different models, but it occurs to me there's an example that I can think of with many older towns and cities have even, you know, not even the sidewalks, but the vehicle ways that don't conform with current standards. I think there are provisions where, for instance, small streets and alleyways and towns are able, you know, towns are not forbidden to maintain and restore them just because they're out of compliance if they were originally built and constrained in that way. And I would have to suspect that there are some similar ways that you could find accommodation for a pedestrian lane. Thinking of the small alleys of you know, places like East Coast cities like Philadelphia, for instance, that are still kept up even though they wouldn't manage to conform to existing standards. I mean, while I'm up here too, the other thing, I think what Jason was doing is very helpful to get the range of possible implications for this from the maximum to, you know, the maximum of a redo to the spot fix it. There are probably some ways, you know, the village makes a decision about how it would like to move ahead and what sort of commitment it would like to make to the pedestrian ways to fine-tune that a bit more. It would seem to me right off that, for instance, the category of sidewalks which were installed or significantly repaired within the last 10 years probably could be excluded from near-term work since they should be good for at least the next 2 to 3 decades. But there's also this difference between repair and fixing, and that may be to do with the age of the sidewalks and other conditions about the, you know, local conditions about them. So some fine-tuning about just what it is that you have would help make the project real. Probably ultimately, I think the suggestion about looking back about what's been done recently helps. Although those have been mostly small repairs, you know, ultimately there's going to be quite a big difference.
Yeah, 3 minutes. Sorry.
Quite a big difference in the costs that are incurred depending on the total volume of sidewalk work. The contractor is going to give you a much more favorable price for hundreds of linear feet versus 1,000 linear feet.
Okay, thanks, Dan.
I'm going to make a somewhat different point.
Your name.
It's about maintenance.
Your name.
Helen Iyer.
Excuse me.
I'm not interested in any new sidewalks if the present ones can't be maintained, and they are not being maintained. And as far as I know, that's a very complicated business. the new ones on the new sidewalk or renewed sidewalk on the east side of Xenia Avenue. There are places where the grass is growing over. There are areas where the water stands. It's still better than some, but that's only been a couple of years. Downtown got all redone on the east side. And I have to say, if there's anything that aggravates me about sidewalks in this town, it's a couple of blocks downtown in winter. And I know it's very complicated because I tried once a few years ago. There are so many people involved in trying to get the snow off and the ice off the curbs downtown, you wouldn't believe it unless you tried. So my point is, if we can't maintain, if there isn't some real evidence that property owners or somebody is going to maintain all these sidewalks, then I don't want to pay for any more. I'm not interested in new sidewalks. I want a place where I can walk.
Ms. Heller?
Dan Kerrigan. Justin.
Jason.
Justin, I'm sorry. I don't know where you got your 17 miles of sidewalks, but if I remember right, during the St. Teresa School, there was only 30% of the village, 25 miles, had sidewalks. So how you can estimate on 17 miles when only 30% of the 25 miles of the village that you plow, which thank you very much, you and the crew do a good job. But I'll take Helen's point that maintaining them is the ones that are already here is just support, that is, especially in the wintertime. Also, I don't know, these discussions about sidewalks are like, as if, the last time I looked at the St. Lucie School statistics and stuff, I don't see us being like Chicago, New York, or Los Angeles, or Orlando, Florida, where we have hundreds of accidents and stuff. As they said at the talk last night, if you want to prevent fatalities, make everyone go slower. If you go 15 miles per hour, there's a very, very slight chance of any fatality, much less crash. There's nothing about sidewalks that is going to magically make everyone happier, especially for Helen or myself. When you go downtown with all the new sidewalks and they're not shoveled, or the downspouts are throwing water onto the road, and black ice is going to get you. So I think the village made a mistake in the ordinance to take over maintenance and operation of sidewalks. It should really look at turning back to the homeowner. The homeowner are responsible for the property, for that right of way, to maintain it, and so also putting it in, or in the case of depending on where you live and how you were platted, it may be an estate acre, acreage. That is, there is no sidewalk. Where I live over Whitehall, there is no need for sidewalks. We have pleasant walking streets, especially now that they've been repaved. You've enjoyed them too. All right, thank you. But I really think the village should just get out of the business of being maintaining and repairing sidewalks. That's my opinion. Thank you.
Thanks, Dan. And that's really what this discussion is about. That's the recommendation of staff, is that the village rescind that ordinance and put the responsibility back onto the homeowner. And just to be clear, when we took on maintenance, it wasn't shoveling, it was concrete. It was making sure the concrete was passable and that there weren't cracks and that there weren't raises. It didn't include any sort of landscaping maintenance or any sort of snow or ice maintenance, only concrete repair. This discussion never gets less complicated. It just seems to just...
less complicated.
Yeah, there are a couple of issues. One is how much do we do on the sidewalks? Do we just like fix the things that are clearly not safe? Do we add some sidewalks in places like Limestone? Do we do all, the whole sidewalks over again? I mean, that's one issue, but then who's responsible for the sidewalks as a second issue?
Right. I mean, we could
That's complicated.
We could very easily have an ordinance come to council. I mean, you know, we could, and just say, just rescind that ordinance. I mean, we're choosing to make a bigger discussion. I think we've had it, the reason for the passage of the ordinance in the first place was the philosophy that sidewalks should be considered as transportation, as roadways. Why are we maintaining the roadways and why wouldn't we maintain the sidewalks or some sort of safe passage? You know, what will happen though is, and clearly the village doesn't have the budget as it is to maintain the sidewalks and do the sidewalk repair that needs to be done. So I feel like we would be looking at some sort of a levy. If we maintain operation, or if we maintain the sidewalks for us to repair and replace, it would have to be done with a levy because there isn't money currently in the budget to do it. So that's really, to me, it's a philosophical discussion. We could, and if council wants to continue that philosophical discussion, or simply take staff's recommendation. I mean, if we simply take staff's recommendation to rescind that ordinance, we rescind that ordinance, and in some respects, this discussion goes away because it becomes the property owner's responsibility again.
It goes away to the extent that we would have to also make sure then that staff is directed to go out and get the sidewalks marked and to enforce the replacement of the broken sidewalks. And that was part of the issue, is we didn't feel at the time that we had staff that were doing that or going to be able to do it.
Have time
to do that.
John, where does this fall on your, because some of the inspection is your responsibility.
This is something that I can't do. One of the things I did in my previous position was do sidewalk inspections, and we had an ordinance where we did assess the property owner for those repairs or ask them to make the repairs if they were presented as a tripping hazard or a private maintenance. So that's something I can do.
Well, and there are some municipalities also that offer a program, and Jason's probably going to hate me for saying this, but offer a program where a homeowner, if they are told that they need to repair their sidewalk, could in fact piggyback on our bid and run it through the village, which normally saves the homeowner a little bit of money, because if we go out the larger quantity, we get a better rate. So that's another option that could be looked at if it were returned to the homeowner.
And that's something that we did in Belk as well, where when the city was repaving certain streets, they had repaved and they also had time come in to replace a curb, and then they would go to the property owners and ask if they wanted to use that contractor to replace their sidewalks as well at a reduced cost. Right. So there was that option.
But then, well, those options have been presented to us.
Right.
So, then we've...
I think we should set up some kind of timeline or something. Make the decisions that we need to make. Because I don't think we want to keep talking about it for years.
No, well, we've been talking about it for a long time. So, I'm sorry, Rose, we'll hear from you.
I'm Rose Pellow. I'm wondering if it goes back to the property owner's responsibility, the property owner was to be notified about their sidewalk being in non-compliance, could they choose to rip out the sidewalk and put gravel in? I mean, like, what, there must be, I'm sure this is a zoning code question about, you know, like, what you're allowed to have on your front lawn and things like that, but that seems like it could potentially be a possibility that homeowners would choose to do something like that rather than repair their sidewalk?
There are provisions typically in subdivision regulations for the terms for the village to accept the street as a dedicated street, and that includes sidewalks. So the sidewalk is not maintained in good repair, then it could be grounds for being a violation of that dedication.
But there are people without sidewalks.
And those are grandfathered, obviously, because subdivision regulations were adopted after that.
Oh, I think one of the council's goals is a walkable, bikeable community. I think you have to decide what you want for sidewalks and bikeways. So you have three types of streets. You have through streets and collector streets and whatever. Look at the various streets from a sidewalk perspective. Where do you need sidewalks? Where do you need sidewalks on one side? Where do you need it on two sides or not at all? I live on a sidewalk that also people drive on, Rice Road. There's no sidewalk there, but there's no problem there either. More people walk on Rice Road than drive on Rice Road. So there's no reason, if you're going to make any improvement on Rice Road, that you have to put in sidewalks. It was being used. Many of the streets in town, they're perfectly fine sidewalks and no one uses them. They walk in the street. Look at that. Decide where you really need sidewalks. And then decide to enforce it. Someone said that the property owner gains from having a sidewalk, uses the sidewalk. I challenge that. The community uses the sidewalk and it should be the community's responsibility to maintain what sidewalks they wish to have. Putting it on the property owner just raises the cost of living in town. So figure out what you really want, really need, and set out a plan to get to that point over time. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. It's feeling to me like this is a little bit of a planning issue. You know, there's some planning involved. It's not just about maintenance of sidewalks. Does the Planning Commission address this at all?
No. I mean, we have the biking committee, but they have not been active. It is first and foremost a repair issue because we don't have the money to make new sidewalks. That's just flat out true. Don't have the money. We're not putting in new sidewalks until there's a federal program, which is where it should come from, frankly. We should be reinvesting in our communities here at home, but we're not at the federal or the state level. In fact, what the state is doing is disinvesting. That's why we don't have money for these things. They'll give us money for streets. They give us zero for sidewalks, right? We get zero for sidewalks. That's the problem. So it's frustrating, but to me, it really is all we can be doing right now is thinking about maintenance. And so that's where I would like to have our focus be. I don't think it's not our goals to rethink the whole where do we need sidewalks and putting in new sidewalks. It hasn't been for this year, certainly. I don't see us having the time to do that this year. So to me, let's figure out who's going to be responsible for repairs.
Right, but we're still talking about $750,000.
Well, I mean, I think what Paul is saying, if you have a gap like this, that needs to be changed. If you have a gap like this, maybe it doesn't. So, I mean, maybe we lower our standards to what is really not safe. What is not safe, and do that.
Well, I just like to address it. As far as our liability is concerned, and it's, you know, I'm not advocating one way or the other when I make this statement.
as far as our liability is concerned, somebody can trip over that, just like they can trip over that. And in fact, they're more likely to trip over this because it's less visible. And so, you know, just since I've been here, we've had at least two instances of folks tripping and being injured and it coming through our insurance because of that. So as far as our liability is concerned, that is not, you know, this little
and
thing where you can just
liable?
Catch your, you, oh yeah, because we're responsible for the sidewalks right now.
The homeowner would have been, or the property owner would have been otherwise.
But, you know, that little thing like that, just enough to catch your toe on and send you flying down the sidewalk. I mean, if you see something like that, you're more likely to step up over it. You don't pay attention to a little lip. So.
And little lips will tip over and power.
Wheelchair.
And I found that out by, we got nice sidewalks on one side of West South College, but my wife hit a little lip and flipped the wheelchair right in front of top of her. So, to me, you know, and I have to kind of agree with Paul, you know, I know we don't have the time to deal with it, but we tell ourselves as being a walkable, bikeable community. And West South College is a good example. We had a bike path and we had sidewalks. And the kids have to ride their bikes in the street. You just cannot ride a bike on the sidewalk, and really the street is not wide enough to accommodate bikes and
vehicles. I know what you're going to say, Dan.
Yeah. So
Dan, you haven't been recognized. Yeah,
but,
we're talking.
But and I mean, we need to make a decision quickly as to which way we're going to go. I agree with you, Lauren. We don't have time to
That's one of the things we're talking about is the only way we have to pay for this if we decide we're going to keep responsibility is through an additional tax levy. So that's part of the timetable to decide what we're going to do for May of 2016 when we have the tax levy for renewal.
Well, I would like clarity on the ADA issue. Just to make sure we get very good clarity on that.
The other thing to remember too is if you're talking about now getting the bicycles to be on the sidewalk as well, which Jerry just said.
No, you cannot do that. It's illegal. It's safest in the streets.
Right. And I don't want to talk about those bike trails. Those asphalt bike trails should have never been put on, and we've got to deal with those. Those are separate issues.
They're very unsafe.
The only issue
should be in the street.
The biggest issue though with those is Xenia Avenue. Xenia Avenue is terrible, and it just has an asphalt.
Asphalt.
Right. I don't want to, you know, Dayton Street and South College have sidewalks. Yes. So what are we talking?
So we need the ADA question answer, which I think Chris is looking into.
And I would like to have Melissa maybe put some millage numbers to that. And again, I thought we had a map somewhere where, I mean, if there is some kind of a survey, a more specific survey of, you know, just like we do the streets, just like we have the street repaving schedule, we need to have a sidewalk.
That shows streets as if they have both sidewalks, one sidewalk, partial sidewalks.
Can you give that to us for the next meeting?
There's an addition we have too. I actually found it today. Rolled up somewhere
okay.
in storage.
Oh, good. That's perfect. Dan?
Dan Kerrigan. Yeah, you don't have a copy of the map. I have a copy of the map. was done by the Antioch students around 2008. Unfortunately, in their exuberance to do the mapping, they didn't know the status of the sidewalks. And there's a bike enhancement committee meeting next Wednesday at John Graham in Mills Lawn, the conference room there. I'd be glad to discuss with anyone about the bike side paths on South College, Dayton Street, wherever else they are. There are some safety issues with them. And we're well intentioned, but a poor design. Riding the street, as someone else here said, is safer. It is safer, statistically, as well as operationally. Thank you.
Okay, so staff has direction on the next part of the discussion. Okay. We're moving on to board and commission roles.
Pardon? I'm sending Jason and Johnny.
Thank you, Jason and Johnny.
Yeah, thanks for your input.
Thanks.
Moving on to board and commission roles and responsibilities, Brian and Mary Ann.
Yeah, so there we made some tweaks just to kind of relate to just small things that I heard at the last meeting, such as, you know, here and after we're referring to commissions, that sort of thing. So I think the only other issue that came up was related to BZA and in particular Planning Commission and this thing about advisory boards. So it occurred to me actually this afternoon that if we just add function as advisory and or quasi-judicial bodies, that I don't think there's anything left in terms of just the language. So I think all that's maybe left to discuss, I know there's some people here that want to talk about the last bullet in particular being subjective. I will say that Judy pulled this out again, it was in our packet last time, the public service values for local elected officials. And I think if we add this as a reference guide, that answers the question about subjectivity, because it has categories and all commission members get this from Judy. It talks about what respect for others means. It talks about what responsibility means. It lays it out in a lot of detail. So I think we reference that in the document. That answers that concern. So I guess ultimately I feel like a lot of work's been done on it. This is a standard that municipalities have across the board. They have all their commissions sign it, whether they're BZA or not. And, you know, I'd like to hear what's still out there to be talked about, but I think it's a great document.
All right.
Thank you.
So basically, we're saying that we think that the council would be ready to vote on.
And the document that basically was on our table that had the changes, so we, contract changes.
Right, and so we could explicitly reference this in the last bullet and add the advisory and or quasi-judicial, because Planning Commission is both. I did a lot of research. I mean, a lot of communities think of BZA as being advisory too, but we could just add that and or in there, and you know, that's not really the substance of this document. The substance of this document, as we said from the beginning, is one, to clarify roles so that commission members who ask for this understand where they sit and how that relates to village staff and council. And secondly, to put some really basic sort of guidelines that anybody representing our local government should follow.
Well, I have some compassion for the feeling that the last point is a little vague. And I think especially the word professional, it can be used against people for the way they wear their hair, for the way a professional is one of those words that is a, it often means you look like a white guy in a suit.
Okay.
And if you don't look like a white guy in a suit, then you're not being professional.
And actually, professional's not on this.
Yeah.
So,
I have a real problem with the word professional in particular.
Yeah.
Is Is that your primary concern?
That's probably my primary concern. I think about whether this is good enough as a reference. My initial response was going to be, I would just say, get rid of that last bullet point. And give them this, but get rid of the bullet point. Because you're signing your name to something, and we need people to volunteer. And we don't want to make a barrier because we're putting in language that people are feeling like, well, what am I exactly signing my name to? Giving them a sheet that explains expectations is one thing. Saying I'm going to be somebody's definition of professional or respectful, responsible, I can see why there's anxiety on that possibility.
Yeah, I'm good with taking out professional. I guess I feel like, though, if we are including this in our packet, I mean, this must mean something. And so using those terms that are, you know, enumerated in this document that, you know, we didn't make up anyway. I mean, we borrowed from municipalities all around Ohio.
What packet are we using this in?
Judy gives this to new commission members as part of their...
I've never seen this before.
Yeah. It was in our packet last time, too, on the 17th. Oh, but yeah, it was online.
HRC meeting. A big part of it is it's all basic. When I volunteered to be on Human Relations Commission, I said to myself, well, I'm going to have to attend these meetings, and I'm going to have to work with these people. I'm going to have to present myself in an ethical manner. I've been censoring my words and being more careful of how I speak with people. So to me, it all seems like it's your job when you put people on these commissions. That's why you ask us for our resume and our interests, because you want to know if we're the kind of people that are going to do these things. And if we're not the kind of people that are going to follow and abide by these rules, having to sign a paper saying that we will isn't going to change that fact. And then again, back to the last bullet point, and I'm not the only person that has said that they will not sign this document with this bullet point on here. I don't feel comfortable with it because I've seen, particularly on social media, a lot of times I've said something that, to me, I'm sitting there thinking this person is kind of laughing, we're having a conversation, and then I find out later, they took it, my words completely out of context because they didn't see my face, they didn't hear the inflection of my voice, and that social media stuff and other stuff is being more prevalent, and having been judged on my words myself, I would not feel comfortable with this because how do I know that that's not going to happen again? Who says to me that they are the arbitrator, the person that decides what is respectful behavior? So I just wanted to point that out. There was not at our HRC meeting, from my recollection, but you could see the minutes, there was a lot of objections to this document. So I have a lot of questions about it.
I do just want to speak to that because we did talk about the two objections from the HRC commission that were, or the HRC that were discussed at our last meeting. And I do want to emphasize that this document went out to all commission members, and those were the only two specific complaints. And I know Steve's here tonight and may want to add something, but beyond that, everyone else in my commissions liked this document. So, you know, I think that's important to remember. So this has been out there for 2 months now.
Mary Ann, have you heard from your commissions?
There, one person was concerned about the vagueness, the subjectivities of those words.
The last bullet.
But I also think that when this document was included, which does a pretty nice job, I think, of explaining. It does not explain ethical, but it does it talks about respect for others and responsibility. And I think it does a good job. So, I mean, I guess I have a question. I have a question for people who are not comfortable. Is the concern that others are going to judge someone about whether that person is being respectful, responsible, and ethical? Or is it not wanting to be respectful, responsible?
Well, that's kind of insulting. Why would you want to be not respectful?
Well, I'm asking a question.
No, it's just a matter of it being too subjective. Who determines what's respectful? Like I said in our HRC meeting, you know, I can be having a conversation with somebody and they recall, say something that somebody else takes offense at, but somebody said the same thing to me, and it would be like, let's just kind of play around. So who's this judge of what's respectful behavior?
Stephen McQueen, Secretary of HRC. I, because of sickness, missed the meeting. But because I'm in charge of the minutes, I watched the entire meeting and this part came up. And yeah, I just had questions as well that I wasn't able to bring up to the meeting, but I knew here. And so I guess the question that keeps getting brought up, but it's who is the judge, what are how do you get reprimanded? Say someone catches me off guard and I do say something disrespectful, do I get a warning that time? Am I immediately shut off? How is that dealt with on a level of someone's having a bad day or you touch the nerve versus someone blatantly being disrespectful or blatantly talking about issues that they shouldn't be in public, that kind of thing. Also, refrain from activities that result in a conflict of interest. The only example given here is financial, but like a proud member of Black Lives Matter, some people consider that anti-police, or they also consider it very segregating, being that it's Black Lives Matter versus All Lives Matter. If someone were to view that as offensive or a conflict of interest because of human relations, which involves all, would that count as something I would need to refrain from? Could someone take that and use that against me or say that I'm not being professional or that I'm not? And so I also felt that that needs to be addressed in what is an activity and what needs to be refrained from. And so, of course, once again, the question, responsible, respectful, ethical, professional. These are all words that can be used for or against someone, however they would like to. What is the goal of this? If we all came, you know, I was interviewed, I was asked how I would address something that would be a conflict of interest. I was asked how I, do I even take everything, or do I really take the time to judge for myself what it is I'm what it is I'm being told, and to be voted for or to vote for or against? I know this coming in, so I just want to know exactly what is this wanting from me, from the council, to a person who's not even paid to do this. I always see it as a way to reprimand people. I don't really see it as a way to help us get along any better than we already seem to.
Thanks, Steve.
I would just like to clarify that IE means, that is to say, it's different from EG. So, you know, just on that point, that's a specific thing about the law, which is that, you know, ethical conflict or conflict of interest means a financial gain. So all that is a definition of what it means. So now we could change that to specifically.
I would probably, because people can be confused by that is versus
right.
Example. For example, I would say, don't use the Latin name.
Yeah.
I.e. use something that's more standard to indicate, because conflict of interest, that's one of the things that's actually driving having something like this, is we have had instances where there was a conflict of interest that we had no idea about because it came up, you know, the person had been appointed and the issue came up later, and we didn't know that they had a financial interest in a decision they were making. And that's really what it applies to, is the financial
right.
interest.
The conflict of interest. I guess I am wondering if, you know, if there is a way for us to just gather the same language that council, that is in council rules and procedures, and you know, why we would, that pretty much lays out, there is something about respectful discussion and conduct in our rules and procedures.
I reread it today, and what we say is what you can't do. You can't make threatening comments, and you can't make can't use profanity, right? Now obviously, profanity can be sometimes a little subjective, but I think in a way I'm more comfortable with that than saying you must be respectful. You must be saying you can't make threats. You can't. That's all. That's as far as I reread it.
Your rules and procedures are included here.
Right. I mean, it talks about ethics.
In that one part.
Right.
And then later on in the conduct of meetings, all it says is at public meetings, neither people on council nor people in the audience, everybody's expected to not use profanity and not use any threatening language. You can be asked to leave.
So do commission members get this Ohio ethics laws in addition to Sunshine Law? Do commission members get the Ohio copies of the Ohio ethics laws?
No, they didn't. They did this.
Correct. Dan?
Hi, I'm Dan Rose here. I wanted to, I think I did this a while back, but maybe I think it's worth raising again a point or a question. I guess it is a point. I've heard a few different comments about this from different perspectives, different commissions. I don't think anyone who's on the volunteer serving end, who I know, is enthusiastic about what's being put forward. And I wonder, in a certain sense, what the rationale for putting it forward is to begin with. But if we're fixing something that's not necessarily broken, because each commission essentially is created by an act of legislation that, in effect, puts together or expresses its rules and expectations. Each commission member is interviewed before they're appointed to that commission. So it seems like a sort of redo of processes that are already in place. Maybe some of them could possibly need legislative tinkering if the commission has a set of rules that aren't serving it, or if council feels that way about a set of rules that aren't serving a particular commission. But the idea of doing a blanket instrument of this sort strikes me as counterintuitive, particularly for a community, for a set of volunteer organizations that are arms of a democratic governance. I mean, essentially, it comes to me more akin to what comes out of HR in a corporate situation where you're trying to have managerial control over a set of workers. And I think that's probably, and I hear a bit of that from people who've already spoken, that they're wondering how they've signed up for this and why they're being asked to negotiate a contract without consideration because they're volunteers in this sort of situation. So I would recommend in this regard to work on the legislation for the commissions if it needs to be worked on, but not try to move forward with an instrument of this sort. Thanks.
Jerry, have you heard from your commissions?
Say I had a mediation. CR.
So we're not?
Yeah, I didn't vote this for them because
I forgot to ask. Yeah. Chris, do you have any, what are your thoughts regarding the legality?
Well,
and what do you see in other communities?
Well, I'll say it this way. One, my role is to give counsel as it pertains to legal matters and to generally abstain from matters of policy. But I will say that what you've seen is a trend that really comes down to these statements of civility. I can speak in law. It happened about 12 years ago where courts started to require lawyers to promise to engage in civil behavior, in a sense, not civil, legal behavior, but be nice, the golden rule. So as we've seen a general deterioration of people behaving badly, the response has been by communities to say, okay, we're gonna make these statements of what expectations are. So legally, I don't think that it's a question of anybody trying to chill anybody to try and say, don't speak. It's more of saying, here's what our expectations are, and just simply follow the golden rule. The trend is to adopt it. I mean, I think the council knows that because this is a kind of a match of things that were felt to fit and reflect the village. And you get into this age-old argument. For example, England doesn't have a Bill of Rights that spells out what all the rights are because they're afraid they'd leave something out. We have an articulated Bill of Rights. Vagueness isn't necessarily a bad thing. I think that when it comes to the golden rule, people know when they see it. The real question isn't whether it's legal or not, it's whether or not this is the right fit for Yellow Springs. And that's really not for me to say as a lawyer in terms of the policy decision of that. There is a practical component from a lawyer's perspective, though, which is that we looked into whether or not the village insurance policy would cover the acts of those commission members? The answer is yes. There is some theoretical liability exposure for somebody who were to act outside the scope or represent the village in some way that was beyond the scope. I mean, those situations are very rare, but theoretically possible. So by having a document like this, it could actually protect the village and protect the individual to say, I'm aware of these things because I signed this piece of paper and my conduct was consistent with the words on the paper. So there is value to that. Again, you know, the problem with when you ask a lawyer a question about what's legal and what's not, we're trained to recognize risk. There are practical risks, and then there's possible risk. I think that this falls into the heading of possible risks. But many communities have determined that this is the best practice, and I would tend to agree with that.
Okay, thank you. I actually like the word stability.
I think I'm really at the point where I would have to get rid of that last bullet point for sure. And I'm a little uncomfortable with, I'm a little bit uncomfortable with the document.
For me, in terms of the last bullet point, whether it's in the document or however it is, I think that it's important that anything we require of commissions, counties require too. But I think it's important that whether when we interview people on commission or whether the commission talks about it, that we understand that we are being held at a higher standard. And it's not just when we're sitting up here, it's when we're in Tom's, or especially I think on social media.
Yes.
That we are being held to a higher standard. And whether a commission sits down and talks about, well, what does that mean? What does respect mean? I mean, maybe just talking about, what does respect mean to me? I mean, there are some things we can agree upon. Calling anyone any kind of name, any kind of derogatory name, is not respectful. I mean, I think everyone could agree with that. And it gets easy and easy, especially in social media, to do that. To be disrespectful. And it's easy, since we do have different kinds of cultures, I guess, as Chrissy said, maybe what doesn't feel disrespectful to her does to someone else. So that makes it even more important, I think, that in those kind of contexts, we have to be very careful.
You know, and I think this in this, you know, there is talk in this particular document about respecting fellow officials, staff, and the public. I think that, you know, I think that there is definitely a level of responsibility to the staff and to everyone in the village to at least be respectful, or we're using a word that people apparently don't think is too subjective, but I agree with Mary Ann. I mean, it's name calling, it's civility. I don't know, civility is just, maybe that's not the right word either, but that seems like the word that I can understand that colors all of this.
And I think one thing to take into consideration as well is when Mary Ann said social media, it is exacerbated by what Chrissy said. You don't see a person's face. You don't hear the tone of their voice. That is the danger of emails and social media and anything that's done electronically. I mean, so it is, there are a lot of things that you need to think about when you're, I mean, I'll sit and type an email and I'll go, oh, wait a minute, I don't want to, that doesn't sound right, you know, I don't want to say that. It, because they're not going to see my face and they're not going to see, you know, look at me and see what I really mean.
Perhaps documents like this need to be given to members, to potential members, before their interview, so that they can understand what is required.
Well, that's what we have been doing since we've had this draft.
Okay.
Everyone that's been interviewed.
Well, what about this public service values?
We have not started coupling them. I will say one thing, when Mary Ann and I first started talking about this, when council agreed that we should explore it, is that we need to create in our commissions a safe environment and encourage participation from citizens. And so that brings me back to, I do think highlighting respect and that responsibility is really important. And, you know, again, when I see this document that enumerates so many things that we're already supporting, I think we need to go beyond just saying that you're ethical. So, I mean, I think we are talking about something beyond that that's important for council too. And I will say, the most complaints that I've heard have not been from commission members about this document. It's been about certain behaviors that maybe we need to highlight are important. And I guess I didn't realize it was going to be this difficult. I mean, it seems straightforward. I mean, one of the things that Chrissy said in our meeting was, these are common sense, your grandmother rules. I mean, and so that's, I guess that's why it's surprising to me that we're sticking on it so much.
I wonder, could we, if people are in agreement with this public service values,
with that at the last bullet?
It's a seek to represent the public service values for local elected officials as articulated on the attached.
I'd be good with that as the last bullet.
But you said seek to represent?
Or represent.
Represent. Uphold, maybe a better word for value, uphold the value, uphold public service values as integrated on the attached document.
I just looked up the source of other words for respect, just to throw them out. Consideration, courtesy, deference, dignity, recognition, regard, just some other possible.
I like this. I like the term public service values. I think that is what we're public servants. People on our commissions are public servants. They're serving the public. I like just using the uphold public service values articulated by the Institute for Local Self-Government or something. Or on the attachment from the Institute for Local Self-Government.
I think that's good. I think it's, to me, it's the same thing, and so I'm happy with
right.
that. And if it makes it more concrete, I agree. I would like everybody to feel good about this document, because it is not driven by any sort of concerns, but it really gets back to what Chris said. I mean, this is the standard practice, and I think we need to have these things in writing and not just, you know, so many commission members came to us and said that we're not really sure what our roles and responsibilities are. So,
do you have any questions?
Can I say one more thing?
Karen? Yeah, go ahead.
I guess part of the reason why I have a big concern about it is, and Brian can maybe help me out with that, with this, it's just a few weeks ago there was an incident where someone claiming that I said something to them out back in the John Bryan Center here that was a very unkind statement, first of all. Second of all, it was something I would never say. So if I've signed something like this and somebody comes up and says, oh, well, Chrissy was really disrespectful to me out back the other night, and even if it's not true, then this statement here would be grounds for me to be kicked off HRC. And I've done a lot of work to be on HRC. I took that appointment really seriously. And I have been working on lots of different issues that are in this document on my own, because I feel as being on that commission, that's part of my responsibility. But I have my own fears, because I have been dabbling in political issues, and I have people that have been doing unpleasant things because they're on a different tactic for me. So personally, I would feel insecure in my position due to that issue. I would feel a little bit vulnerable because of that statement being the way it is.
One of the things we took out of this document that is was in the Dublin document was any sort of teeth in the sense of you will be admonished or punished or anything like that. And that was very purposeful. I agree with Mary Ann about removing those things. I see this more as a way to have a conversation about those things, but not as, it doesn't mean that you get removed from a commission.
I think we basically agreed that to take that last sentence out.
Well, we agreed to change it to uphold the public service values articulated by the Institute for Local Solid
Government. Yeah, I mean, yeah, we've rewritten the sentence, but it does not read the way the person reads.
Right.
So respect, responsibility, ethical, that stuff is not there anymore.
Well, effectively it is.
Well, it is because it's in that.
Yeah, but everything is sort of defined here.
By the heading of fairness, compassion, okay, we got respect for others. But it is defined. The rest of the responsibility, integrity, public trust, and vision. So.
Well, if council is not ready to adopt this, which I'm sort of seeing, and I'm also looking at the clock, 7 o'clock. Should we say we'll look at this and give people a commission more time and come back to the president?
I mean, if we're agreed to change that, and Lori has not, do you take it to planning commission? You said you,
I haven't taken it to planning commission. I haven't thought of it.
Well, I think that the direction we've been going was to say that it may not apply to planning commission or BZA, but I think right. The way Brian is changing it, he's changing it so that it will. So let's make those right. Changes, get it back out again to the commissions. And, you know, again, I don't have any commissions, so I don't have much
to base
it on.
Would be related to
so.
Commission. I know it doesn't, mediation's now.
It's not really, it's not a commission, it's not a village commission.
Community resources.
Right, that just wouldn't apply to non-village appointed committees.
Yeah, that's.
Well, I think the library commission is technically commissioned, so it would apply to that.
And I think the other, you know, it would apply to any, even ad hoc, it would apply to ad hoc
right.
groups.
Right,
it would basically
so like
apply to anybody
sure.
that has been appointed by the village. And you know, and could this, you mentioned that some communities actually swear people in.
They swear
Could this be taken care of simply by swearing anybody in that we choose to serve on a commission or a board? Would that serve the same purpose?
We would still have that in writing? I mean, you know, I think part of this is I now have something that I can refer to, so I understand. You know, I don't want to forget about the initial part too, which is, you know, the roles that we all play in village government.
But I think it does become is the fact that it's a signed document. Mm-hmm. Council doesn't sign a document that says we're going to do such and such. We're sworn in.
You sign your oath.
Oh, we do, so okay. But that is a different, in some respects, it's still somewhat different.
Let's get this redone. I'll get it to planning commission, get it to library commission, and I am sorry it's taking so long. It's funny how things on council work that way.
Right, but it's fair enough. I mean, as I said, I hate for this to be a document that people don't all like see value in. So, so I'm willing to be patient in that regard.
And yeah, as Lori said, I mean, until discussion happens and until you start to get through something, you don't always think of all of the issues that might be involved. So, okay, let's move on.
Move to the retreat and play
okay.
The goals
for the retreat. Okay.
Yeah.
And just to note, I mean, I think that the goals document has been updated pretty well. So Okay, selection of retreat date.
Thank you.
Times, and so I had a proposal in here. So we've got March 31st is the date that we, that has been determined is the only date we're all available. Chris?
Yes, Amy and I are planning on attending.
Okay. We talked about various locations. Judy and I have been talking about locations. I mean, we've been through all of the B&Bs. I thought about the 888 Dayton Street building. It's completely empty. There's a conference room in the old Antioch University space. The only thing I will say is that my last statement isn't correct. It doesn't have, the building doesn't have Wi-Fi. I don't know if that's a, how necessary that is. But it had, it's fully furnished. There aren't tables. There aren't large enough tables, though. But there are as many chairs as we could possibly need, and it's a large room. We didn't, problem with B&Bs, and there would be no charge. The problem with B&Bs is that we would have to pay, and there's typically not a guarantee of privacy.
I did ask about Rockford Chapel, and even that is $100 to use, but it's available.
Our firm grants would be in downtown Dayton, but we have a large conference room that would accommodate anybody who wanted to attend. And that I could make that, easily make that available if that helps.
What about the library?
I don't think it's not quiet.
It's not. You can hear through the wall.
Bill, can we move tables down to 888? Lori wanted to start at 9:30 on that day. That gives Jason tons of time to get the tables down. Lori starts at 7:30 if we ask ahead.
Okay, yeah, 9:30. I like that idea anyway.
But for $100, going to Rockford Chapel, that room they have, it's nice and big. It has table, chairs, and kitchen.
$100. Right. The Yellow Springs Arts Council has the multi-purpose room in the back with tables and everything, and they are closed on Tuesdays.
I mean, it has windows.
There's some windows back there.
It's not that bad.
And,
it's right down by restaurants.
I think it would be available.
Yeah, I think I like Rock. Well, I mean, it's $100 charge.
But it is going to a good cause.
$100 is not.
Yeah, but now I don't think that's going to occur. And we would be guaranteed having the space.
Yes, I he's holding it. I just said I would let him know Tuesday morning. Okay. Either way, but so that's fine.
Yeah,
I like
that's good. And is house parking? Parking is okay. It
should be just fine.
Yeah.
Right down at the end of President Street, there should be an issue.
Rockford Chapel is right on the campus, or just off
of President Street. It's next to Paul Bannis. It's next to the, what used to be the President's House.
It's a kitty corner from the Dharma Center.
Or kitty corner from the Antioch, from the Midwest.
We'll
have
a map at the next
meeting.
Yes.
Right near the street.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the
street
at that end is only 2 blocks long.
Yeah. The topics at the top were things that kind of came from Patty, came from Judy, came from Mary Ann. I didn't really hear from a lot of other people. And, you know, it amazing. It's just about the same agenda we had last year.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, I noticed you left interim village manager on that.
Where?
Under tentative agenda.
Sounds like it was the agenda last year.
You probably need to add John to that as well.
How about if we just say staff?
There There you go.
Yeah, because that would also include the legal fee.
Sounds like you need it.
So I would say if you have a burning need for something to be discussed at this retreat, send it to me, and if we need to do any tweaking, we've got one more meeting, so. But I,
And Judy, why don't, you know, we can talk about food, we'll have breakfast and lunch, or just snacks, muffins maybe and some fruit.
Yeah. We don't really need breakfast.
Coffee would be good.
Okay, water.
Good. So, let's see, nomination for HRC alternate.
Yes, so Mary Ann and I interviewed Scott Osterholm, and he's written a little bit for us. He's got a history here going to the high school, and he's now back working again. I personally was very impressed with his perspective, which will add some diversity to the HRC. Now, this is for an alternate position, but we have two alternates technically. Mary Ann, I don't know if you want to add anything.
Well, one thing we talked about when we started talking about this is how do you handle conflict in that situation? And he, I felt like he did a good job of addressing that. He's managed crews on work projects. He manages, two people aren't getting along when he does that. So I felt good about how he answered the questions, and he does have sort of good roots in the community.
I'd like to
make a motion to appoint Scott Osterholm as an alternate to the HRC.
So we have a second, Mary Ann?
Yes, I'll second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Manager and assistant manager report.
Since most of the audience is gone, the first bullet point there, the public meeting for the water softening options is scheduled for Wednesday, March 18th from 7 to 9. It does sit here in council chambers, but I think we might have a few too many people for that, so we will try to get A and B. The only thing that I want to really stress is that originally, we had intended for there to be two meetings on water softening. However, H&TV has done a really good job of investigating all of the various options. They have a very nice presentation that they're going to bring to council as far as the different options. And I want everyone to be aware that this may potentially be the only public meeting on water softening that we have. And so if someone is out there who is interested in voicing an opinion, hearing the presentation, please make every effort to be here for that meeting. If you cannot be here, please feel free to email either myself or Judy. Email me, copy Judy, email a council member sometime prior to that date. We will have the presentation from H&TV a little bit ahead of time, so it will be online just like a packet so that folks can review that and have all of that information. So I think it's important to get the word out that to everyone who may be interested in that discussion that they should try to be here for the 18th if at all possible. Our application to host two ICMA International Fellows from Southeast Asia for the month of May was accepted, so we will be having two people with us from Southeast Asia. They will be working on a village social media policy and presence. We will be asking some of our residents, I think Brian has already made some contacts, to host some short homestays for them or perhaps provide a meal. Once or twice. They do get a stipend for most of their stay, but part of our obligation is to provide them with a certain amount of interaction with the community. So if you're interested in doing that, please let either myself or councilman, councilperson Hausch know.
Public Works is still going to put in that storm drain on Davis Street, Mary Ann, so you're going out of town at the right time. If they can get the snow out of the way and the frozen ground dug up. Wayne Cannon from RCAP would like to do a training session with council on the rate analysis and the implementation of those things. He says it will take about an hour, and he suggests perhaps before the softening meeting.
So this would just be for the council?
It would be for the council, but it would be a public presentation.
Yeah, I think it's too much on one night, I think.
Okay, so.
I'm going to be gone, I mean, I guess, so it doesn't matter.
So if council can look at their schedules and maybe email me a couple of different times when you might think before this meeting or that meeting, might be a good option. Obviously, we all know about council chamber renovations.
Are you?
You want to touch on some?
No. No, you want a date in the future, or do you want a date before the 18th?
No, in the future.
In the future.
But just before we get the rate study, which will be about 2 months, maybe three. We have time. My last thing is the chili cook-off was a success. We had 12 entries. It was a good time. Thank you to council for judging and to Ruth Ann for putting it all together. As I said, hey, I want to do this, which is what normally happens. And I said, hey, I want to do this, and Ruth Ann makes it happen. So that's all I have.
Okay, thanks, John.
You guys already read the allied education report. We talked about the charrette at Antioch College. I plan on attending a couple of sessions tomorrow, as well as a session focusing on the village staff on Wednesday. Also on Tuesday, there's going to be a preliminary pin-up review, open house, what they've done. And then on Thursday will be the final presentation from 6 to 8, and that will be at the Wellness Center in the college.
Since we're talking about, sorry, the charrette, is anyone, because I have a few times on my schedule, is anyone else planning on going?
I was very confused because I just wasn't sure what we're allowed.
Right.
Judy, it's all open.
Yeah.
Well, no. Yes, but can council, the question is, can five council members go to the village? We can't deliberate, though. That's according to our rules, we can't. Chris, do you know the situation?
I read something in the packet, but I'm not sure I quite understand the scope.
A charrette is basically a public input session, and what these small breakout sessions are basically like they invite community stakeholders, like neighboring residents or business owners, to small roundtable sessions where they get input from those people.
For instance, Wednesday they've invited village staff and council for input on utilities and things like that. And the question is, if it's a small group and they're asking for our input, how many council members could properly attend?
And the definition of the process is that we're supposed to be providing input. It's not a listening session.
But they're breakout sessions where one or two council members may be talking specific.
No, it's all one session.
And all of you would be there?
Yes.
You can answer informational questions, but you can't deliberate on policy matters or make policy. But you can answer informational questions.
So if the question were to come up, would the village be able to provide this, that, or the other under certain circumstances, that would probably not be a good thing to discuss.
Right.
I would tend to agree with that.
And those kinds of things staff could potentially answer. So council, I was planning on going. I thought Mary Ann was going to get some that she can. So
Wednesday.
I feel like only two council members should go to that.
On Wednesday?
To the Wednesday one.
That would be the safest, though, to comply with Sunshine Law. However, if more than two went, just you have to be mindful of what you can and can't do, but it would limit the participation of the three members who were there.
Is it 11:30 on Wednesday?
Yeah, 11:30.
And that's our village staff?
Well,
I could go, or...
Okay. Well, actually, I was going to also go on Tuesday, so if you were going to go on Wednesday, that's fine.
I'll go on Wednesday.
Okay. Are you going to one, Jerry?
I'll let you guys go. You say you're going to Tuesday.
tomorrow, yeah, tomorrow, at 10.
For what? What's the topic?
Business.
Oh.
Right, that's the one that you...
And I'll be attending the business owner one as well as this one after that for developers that I might sit in on as well.
I mean, I'm going to the business one too, so Jerry, if you want to go to the, I mean, although it is totally different input, I mean, it's totally...
Okay.
So if you want to go to the village one.
Wednesday at 11:30, Jerry.
And another thing is, like, you don't have to attend these just specific breakout sessions. You can show up whenever. They've got their team on the side doing design and other things. You just kind of look over their shoulder or, you know, talk to them on the side as well, instead of having to participate in the
session. And I'll go to the one Wednesday if you plan on
it. Yeah.
In business.
Cool. So that is going on this week. It's pretty exciting. I began the preliminary work on doing permit fee revisions, and I started with the ordinance that we'd adopted in 1993, and it's gone through some extensive revisions. There's a lot of things that have changed since 1993 in our zoning code and what we are permitting, so it's definitely kind of evolved on its own. So hopefully I'll be collaborating with some people further down the line to kind of get more firm numbers on these revisions, but there are things that need to be changed, specifically the way the village looks at permit review for large projects, because that is completely different from what is in the 1993 code, so that's been changing the zoning code. So I'm working on that. And then finally, we're continuing our discussions with Rebecca on the Wi-Fi. We're meeting with Mario in the school on Thursday, with Thor, and we'll hopefully be talking about ways that we can get this to work. It looks like I'm hoping that our numbers can come to a point where we can be able to move forward with this in the next few months. So
this is the wireless mesh project, just so that we've heard about before.
Yes, this is the wireless mesh, that's correct. So that's basically it. I had a cold and I was not an issue, so it was a little bit busy.
The permit fees, that won't come before planning.
It will come before planning commission first, and then it'll go to council. Okay. So you'll and also, just to kind of piggyback on boards and commissions stuff from earlier, I'm looking at updating the bylaws for both the planning commission and board of zoning appeals, and that will take into account what the language that we're discussing for the boards and commissions. I see those two as intertwined. Yeah. Playing off each other, so that'll influence the bylaws for both those commissions.
And you mentioned something in an email, I guess today or yesterday, about swearing in of our quasi-judicial body.
That needs to happen in the meeting.
Yes.
Next meeting, basically.
Good.
Judy?
Well, ironically, I wrote about how much time you all spend on your duties as village council folks, and I announced it as Village Council Awareness Evening to occur between 8 and 10 p.m. And as you see, I'm well past that hour. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Looking at future agenda items, we will have the two pieces, the two ordinances will be back. Marriage equality resolution will be on that agenda. We should probably be just putting together an agenda for the Township Trustee meeting. I can put together, Chris had mentioned getting together. I'll get together with Chris and put something together before the next meeting and have it on our agenda.
And I'll work with you on an agenda, more finalized agenda for the retreat.
And what are we doing with the goals?
We'll talk about those at the retreat. Let's just put those on the retreat agenda.
On the retreat, I think.
It isn't on the retreat agenda.
Well, the retreat agenda is not finalized. I honestly think if you brought, I mean, you are so close to done, just like a quarter inch from dropping into the cup. So if you just brought it back on the 16th, I think you'd be done.
I don't disagree with that.
Okay, yeah, that's fine.
I disagree. Because I'm looking at, the more I look at those three and four, you know, our goal, for example, on four is
say the goal to view the budget each month, then we have things listed under it. To me, those are activities required to meet a goal.
I thought we decided that goal number three was develop a strategy for fiscal sustainability.
Okay.
So I don't know why that other stuff.
Well, I'm looking at the sheet that I got.
So why don't we just discuss it?
So, yeah.
Let's discuss it. Let's bring it back onto the 16th.
A little editing, but I mean, we're very close.
Yeah.
But if you say that those are the changes, then I think it's going to be easy for me to work. I didn't see it. The sheet that I got had changed.
We'll put it on the 16th and maybe we can make changes on it.
Yeah.
And perhaps we can all really look at this and make sure we bring whatever we think needs to be.
Brian and I filled out ours pretty extensively, so look and see what we did.
And we added the values in the header.
And you guys did a good job.
Yes, I wanted the gold star.
At this point, council retreat will finalize agenda. Goals. And at this point, that's all. Well, are we bringing back roles and responsibilities?
I will update the document and if we need to discuss it further.
Do we have anything else for, what about the utility ordinance policy and the sidewalks? Are we bringing both of those back? I think the utility, we need to keep moving on that.
I'll have the additional information.
And it sounded like you said we were going to talk about it at the next meeting. So.
Right.
And, given how long it's
been, yeah, this is,
maybe we shouldn't, like, if we're going to do utility, then maybe we shouldn't do sidewalk.
Right. I agree. I think those two are too big.
So
potentially you could allocate the next 3 to 4 meetings to one or the other and then move on.
I would like to get one of them done. So I think the utility, we've got the engagement of a lot of citizens. I think that's the one we move forward with.
Yeah.
Okay. And so engaged. Sidewalks will move back down to future agenda items.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, good idea.
That's too much.
And then as soon as we finish the utility, we can go back to.
Yes. You know, when it comes to sidewalks, you know, maybe because John has experience with this, maybe you could put together some thoughts about how to get us to this discussion, because we just keep going in all kinds of different directions. If you could help us focus.
Sure.
So I think that is probably enough. So the next meeting is March 16th. Lori will be gone. In a very fun place, having a great time. Mary Ann is smiling.
Yeah. So Mary Ann, you're leaving on the 4th and coming back on the 14th. And then Lori, you leave on the 16th.
We're really not supposed to talk about when we're gone on television. Oh. So I'll talk to you about it afterwards.
Okay, can I get a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, so please say aye.
Aye.
Aye.